prologue here. The riders making their starts, 169 of them, composing of 19 teams. I'm Phil Liggett, joined, of course, by Paul Sherwin. Well, the prologue was held in great conditions. The winner was Bradley McGee in 8 minutes and 30 seconds. Olaf Pollock putting in a surprise second place, and Yaroslav Popovic, watch out for him, in third place and off to a great start. Which takes us now to the first opening stage of the Giro d'Italia. A ride of 143 kilometres from Genoa to Alba. And the man in pink, Bradley McGee of Australia, only the second rider ever to pull on the leader's jersey for Australia in the Giro d'Italia.
Well, Brad McGee certainly was the big favourite before the start, but I think everybody now is looking forward to the first road stage. Olaf Pollock, one of the big sprinters, will be looking to try and get himself the pink jersey on the first day out on the open roads, because there is going to be a major battle for the time bonifications.
Well, defending champion Gilberto Simoni, by the way, has come to form bang on schedule, because he hasn't been riding that well this year. But he seems to be now finding his legs, and he'll be wearing, of course, number one in a very strong team from Saeco. We're looking here now at the overall situation after that prologue time trial. A good win there by McGee. And this is one of his big targets of the year. He's planning the Tour de France and at the Olympic Games as well. There's the route for us along the coast as we head now towards Alba. 143 kilometres, that's about 79 miles. Not too many challenges on the way. And a big chance now to see if Alessandro Petacchi can continue in the way he's accustomed and win the stage for the sprinters.
Ideal course for the sprinters this afternoon. And of course, don't discount Mario Cipollini, who, although he's had a very quiet season so far this year, I think is also going to try and get himself a stage victory if he can. Rolling away from the start, all of the riders now on the first road stage, and there's time at 13:39 as they move away. And in the main field, Alessandro Petacchi, I would think, very nervous at this time of the day.
Yes, the cheers of the crowd. It's been a good start here in Genoa. Very good prologue time trial, not least, of course, for Brad McGee. And the riders in good spirits. 169 of them taking to the start today. A couple of small sprints along the way. There's the defending champion, Simoni. Pressure will be on him from day one, I think. This is a very, very good course this year. They're picking up the action now as a familiar sight here. The Damiano Cunego team of Fassa Bortolo and the team of Robbie McEwen's Lotto squad all beginning to mix it for the sprint.
There's Naudus there, the champion of Latvia. He's one of the men who's made the big change this year. He's looking after Mario Cipollini. Cipollini's team on the front there with a very good sense of organisation. But look at the blue and white jerseys of Fassa Bortolo trying to get the sprint sorted out for Alessandro Petacchi.
Well, Marlon Perez has been away an awful long time today, but he's back in the pack now, and the whole field are beginning to scent here. They're on a four circuits of only 5 kilometres here in the town of Alba. Chance to see the world champion, Igor Astolo, has not done much at all this year. He switched across to Lamprey after the bad start he made earlier with Cofidis.
That was a quick glimpse there. Number 71 was Mario Cipollini, a long way back, and in fact get himself pushed back even further to around about 25th position. The organisation now in the blue and white jerseys on the front is Alessandro Petacchi's team. They seem to have got this race completely and utterly under control. And I don't think, Phil, we're going to see Cipollini in this sprint because he's much too far back.
Well, Petacchi's 4 wins under his belt already this year. He's 30 years of age now, but he really has started to blossom. 30 wins last year, that was more than anybody else. And he's trying to open his account again in the Giro d'Italia. What a difference Paul, a year makes, because Damiano Cunego were the stars for Cipollini last year.
They certainly were, but this year this team has really developed into being a team who this year in the Giro d'Italia are only going to ride for stage victories, because they have nobody at all who's got a chance of riding high in the overall classification. Right on the front line now, Fassa Bortolo in fifth position. There is Alessandro Petacchi. Robbie McEwen on his wheel, looking to try and see if he can get himself a stage victory. McEwen also looking for some glory at this time of the season before taking a break and getting himself ready for the Tour de France.
Well, I'll tell you what, this is a great lead out now, and there's still plenty of firepower on the front there from Fassa Bortolo. The last man on the line is Petacchi. Cipollini doesn't seem to be able to get into this at all. And we thought he might try to continue his winning ways and improve his overall record in the Giro d'Italia, which he now holds. But just look at this now, as Bortolo are really setting the pace here. This is going to be a good one now. As we look at the head of the race, they've come off that corner very wide, but there's nobody getting a look in here.
Well, there's a lot of teams actually swarming up to the front, and I can see one or two riders from Mario Cipollini's team moving forward as well there. Maybe Cipollini has recovered somewhat as they come into the last couple of kilometres, but nobody's taking the control away from Fassa Bortolo right on the front end of the main field. Dario Cioni very high up to the front end of that line. There's a big battle, though. If you're just looking about fifth or sixth position, everybody is fighting to get the wheel of Alessandro Petacchi. Robbie McEwen there moving himself up now into fifth place, looking nice and calm, waiting for the sprint to open up and then hoping that he can catapult himself off the back wheel of Alessandro Petacchi.
Well, this is Testato followed by Ongarato, the familiar lead-out squad now for Alessandro Petacchi. McEwen has got the right wheel. Little bit of elbowing, bumping and barging, but McEwen has this habit of popping out at the finish. And McEwen, remember, in this race for sprint wins, because he's not going to go the distance. He never does in the Giro. He's thinking more of the upcoming Tour de France. There's now a move up on the outside.
That's Lombardi trying to move himself up towards the front. I don't think he's got Cipollini on his wheel, because Cipollini a few moments ago was around about 25th place. Still Fassa Bortolo. We're inside the ultimo kilometro now, the last kilometre. There's the world champion riding very much to the front end of the field, and there in about fifth or sixth position, the champion of Latvia, Laudzuts.
And just look at McEwen there, checks his brakes but still goes through on the wheel of Petacchi. Robbie has put himself in a good position here. Just three riders from Fassa Bortolo, then followed by the riders from Domenico Vacanzi. It looks though Cipollini's trying to get in there, just on the wheel too.
That's Cipollini in fifth place. Yep, he's really recovered.
On the wheel of Andres Oge. But now Cipollini still trying to get on the act here now. This is a very determined effort by Big Mario. There he is on the right of our picture. But now look at the real effort here. The big lead out coming from Andres Oge here. And that's the teammate of Cipollini, but he's taking the wrong man to the line. Look at McEwen now trying to grab a wheel. McEwen's hit the front. Here comes Petacchi on the left as we look at the picture now. Alessandro Petacchi is taking a pulse, getting through the middle. But on the line, he gets it. He opens his account on the very first full day of the Giro. Alessandro Petacchi gets the sprint there. Olaf Pollock, I think, might well have taken second place. Have a look at this.
Well, let's look at this from the aerial shot. There's Robbie McEwen. He decided to go for a long one, getting the jump if he can on Alessandro Petacchi. Right on the front there, Domenico Vacanzi leading out. They hope for Mario Cipollini. But look at the acceleration of McEwen there, cutting right across. I think the judges might have something to say about that as well, because McEwen goes right across the road there, opening up the gate, though, for Alessandro Petacchi in the blue and white. And once this man kicks the turbo in, he is absolutely phenomenal. Look at the way Polak has squeezed through that gap there. Second across the line. Now, Phil, that is going to put Olaf Polak very close to the pink jersey.
It'll certainly give him the points lead, because he's got 2 second places now. So he can look forward to wearing the points if he hasn't got the pink. There are small bonuses as they cross the line. And in fact, Crescenzo D'Amore has popped into third place there, pushing Robbie McEwen out into only fourth. He faded pretty quickly at the line, didn't he? Look at the face there of Petacchi. He's going to feel pretty pleased with himself. Win number one this year's at Giro d'Italia. And in fact, win number five for the season.
Well, that was a great ride there by Alessandro Petacchi. As we look down, there's confirmation just ahead of Polak and D'Amore. Robbie McEwen fading a little bit towards the end into fourth place, and Marco Zanotti moving up into fifth. Watch out for Philippe Gilbert, the Belgian rider off the F2Jeux.com team, because he's got a very good chance of finishing in the top three over the next couple of days.
Speaking big things about Philippe Gilbert back home in Belgium, but there's the flowers for the top sprinter of the moment, with 30 wins to his credit last year. He's already on the board here in the Giro d'Italia. Overall, Paul, you are right. Pollock has taken the lead by 2 seconds over Bradley McGee, 20 seconds over Petacchi. Popovic's the big danger, I think, amongst that leaderboard at the moment. So Olaf Pollock of Gerolsteiner has given Germany the lead in the Giro d'Italia.
Well, it's going to be a big battle again, I should think, tomorrow, because the sprinters do have a very good chance of staying in at the front end of the race. Although I have a feeling there are one or two little climbs out on tomorrow's course, which are going to make it that very much more difficult.
Well, this one takes the riders now from Novi Ligure to Pontremoli. It's an uphill finish, by the way, at Pontremoli. 184 kilometres, that's around about 114 miles. One third and one second category climb along the way. The intergiro sprint as well, that most complicated of competitions for its own jersey. And as we're coming up here now to the top of the Passo del Bocco, a little bit of a break on. I'm sorry, Oh, this is the Passo del Bretello. So this puts us now at 20 kilometres from the finish here.
As you can see, it's been a pretty hard day. A lot of riders have been left struggling to try and stay in contact with the main field. And in fact, one or two riders who've been left behind here are riders, in fact, like Alessandro Petacchi and Mario Cipollini. I think it was Alexander Moose who went across there in first place, just ahead of Damiano Cunego and Gilberto Simoni. By the way, Cunego, a lot of people feel, has got a very good chance of riding high in the overall classification in this race. He comes into this event with 5 victories in the last month of racing.
That's right. And he comes in now, not quite the youngest rider in the race. He was the youngest rider last year when he tasted the Giro for the first time, and he finished on the winning team from Saeco. Well, they've swept up all the breakaways now, and this is a big, there's been plenty of them today, but it looks as though they're taming the situation because they know the climb up to the finish of Pontremoli. Not a mountain by standards, but a tough climb nonetheless. A little bit of cramp being shaken out the legs there, that rider there from Alessio.
Well, Brad McGee's got a very good chance of getting himself back the pink jersey this afternoon, because in fact the overnight leader, Olaf Polak, is a long way behind in this race, as are the majority of all of the other sprinters. Big organisation on the front for Team Saeco, and as you can see, Panaria also on the front there feel they've got a very good chance of getting the win. Moving up on the right-hand side is the world champion, Igor Astroloa, just moving teams away from Kofidis now to ride for Lamprey. He too will be trying to get himself a win if he can, just to bolster his chances and, of course, to try and show off his world champion's jersey.
Well, Astroloa, with his wins last year, one classic and one world title, wasn't bad for a couple of wins, was it? But he's had a sorry start to the season, joining Cofidis, the drug scandal that's hit them there. He was allowed to move on, and he's now gone over to Lamprey. Nice to see him at the front of the action. 2 kilometres to go, not far away from the climb now, up towards the finishing line. And interestingly, Paul, it is Saeco, and here they are at the front of the race, and they've scored well in the mountains today as well.
Watch out though for Bradley McGee just on the left-hand side there. He'll be looking to try and get himself a time bonus to make himself that little bit more solid at the top end of the overall classification. I don't suppose he expected at all he was going to have a crack at getting his pink jersey back here this afternoon.
Well, he might need a small time bonus if he does. He's 2 seconds off, remember, at the moment, but I haven't seen Pollock in that little group.
Pollock has had a hard time over these little undulations on the run in towards the finish. We're inside now the last kilometre, but the team who've got complete control at the front end is Team Saeco, and I would expect today that they will try and set this up for Damiano Cunego, because coming into the Giro d'Italia, he really was on fire.
Well, if Cunego does a challenge, who's going to lead the Saeco team? Of course, over 3 weeks, we're going to find out the answers to those questions. Well, working very hard, and he looks like Gilbert again is just on the front there of Brad McGee. So the FDJ boys have got a great interest in this result.
Well, you can see Gilbert there. He's on the front. He's taken the lead now. In fact, he's not thinking about his own position here this afternoon. It's more about the position of Brad McGee. McGee wants to get back the pink jersey, but he's going to have to fight off Cunego there, who's in fourth place.
Yes, a very tight bend, this one. Well, this is a great lead out by Gilbert. And Bradley McGee, having won the prologue and taken pink, he'll put himself back into the jersey here. Looking down the quick pan of the peloton, I don't see the Maglia Rosa worn today by Olaf Pollock at all. He's had a tough day out in it. But look at this now, McGee leading out the two Saeco riders. That doesn't all well for the result. He does need the time bonus. And as he comes over the top of the line here now, McGee is riding like a champion just now. He's being challenged, though, by Damiano Cunego. And it looks like Mereni and Cunego, the young man on the team, has stolen the stage ahead of Bradley McGee. But that should be enough for McGee to go back in pink.
That should be enough, but there's the winner of the stage, this man getting his first ever stage victory at the Giro d'Italia. What a great win by Team Saeco. Now this team will now feel that little bit more relieved. They've got the victory they were looking for, and now they can think about the win of Gilberto Simoni. A very quick glimpse there of the next group on the road. Alessandro Petacchi in that group, as you can see there, the leader of the Ciclamina competition, and as well Robbie McEwen. So the majority of the sprinters here losing a large amount of time this afternoon.
Well, the main base of the leaders are here, and they have lost an enormous amount of time, really. There won't be no return to the top like there has been for McGee, because Pollock now is losing too much time here. And these are the Fassa Bortolo riders. They'll be in action again as time goes on. There's Pollock as well. The early leader in the King of the Mountains will be Fabian Wegmann. So it's not all doom and gloom for Gerolsteiner as the peloton arrive here. No big effort at all. 2 minutes and 39 seconds behind.
But let's not forget, for Gerolsteiner, they are counting on David Rebellin, who is very comfortably in that leading group. But that's had a very serious sort out on the second day on the open road. But look at this. At this moment, I actually thought that Brad McGee had done just enough to get himself the win. But look at the acceleration coming by here from Damiano Cunego. And don't forget, that little man on the right, on the left-hand side there in the red jersey, has been a former world champion himself at the under-23 level of the sport. And Igor Astroloa, the current world professional champion, coming up to show that he is riding himself into form here at the Giro.
And there he is, nearest camera, nearly 40 kilometres an hour, just off 25 miles an hour. The wind going to Damiano Cunego, McGee, Astroloa, Mazzolini it was in fifth, Trampusch, Rebellin. The man they've missed out there is in fact the third place rider, which was Mereni, as he made that third place finish. Well, this is the moment everybody waits for, and for some reason in the Giro d'Italia, they never can open the champagne. But here we are, Damiano Cunego's great year continues. 32 seconds of the overall lead now. It swings back to Brad McGee of Australia. Popovic up into second and Trampusch in third. Cunego has come right in now.
Those really are large gaps at the top end of the overall classification. But with a taste of the mountains to come tomorrow, I wonder if Brad McGee really thinks he can hold on to that pink jersey. 32 seconds ahead of Yaroslav Popovic. And Trampusch, well, I think he may well disappear as well from the top 10.
All right, well, let's move on then to stage three now. We go on to the Corno alla Scala, and that's, by the way, is where Alberto Tomba, the famous downhill ski champion from Italy, learned to ski. We're scaling the heights now as we move on, 191 kilometres, about 120 miles, from Pontremoli to the highest point in the Bologna Apennines. There's a little preview for you. Snow on the mountains of winter, and Tomba was the man that brought fame to the Corno alla Scala. Well, today we've got a couple of climbs too, and on the way we can expect that perhaps Saeco will try to take a little bit of control. It's going to be a tough day for Brad McGee, that's for sure.
Very difficult day for Brad McGee, who's, I think, very surprised to get himself back into the pink jersey after conquering the opening day's prologue, which he expected to win, and everyone put him down as a number one favourite. He's also looking forward to go through to the Tour de France, and he's putting himself, I think, Phil, down to a very, very difficult season because he wants to go for the Tour of Italy, which he's already succeeded at, the Tour de France, and, of course, the Olympic Games.
We're looking here at the early move of the day from Tenax, Arinzo Mazzolini, who's been riding pretty well. He got away after about 38 kilometres today, and they've more or less left him out there for a while, 84th overall, 4 minutes, 3 seconds behind. So he's not a big worry just yet. To remind you, the leaders just now, apart from the pink for McGee, we've got Cunego wearing the points. Alexander Moos has got the King of the Mountains back off at Wegmann. And Marzoli is the Intergiro leader.
Well, Marzoli there at the moment had built himself up a maximum lead of 16 minutes. Mazzolini, I meant to say.
That's right. He's the younger brother of the Eddie Mazzolini, or Renzo.
Well, he had built himself up that massive advantage, but I think the writing is certainly on the wall, because at the front end of the main field there's been a lot of red jerseys from Team Saeco. They must feel very confident here this afternoon that either Gilberto Simoni or, of course, Damiano Cunego have got a very good chance of taking over the pink jersey, because they're the men who are coming into this race on exceptionally good form. And I think we can see at the side of the road there, there's some very interesting artistry going on.
Peloton. Continuing here, no big pressure. That's a fantastic piece of work, I have to say. It's taken a long time to do that. Now, the Saeco boys clearly have got ambition here today now. I wonder if they can move Cunego right up the ladder here and give him the pink jersey. They're starting to pull back Mazzolini.
Well, this is a bit tough because the man on the front is also Mazzolini, but that's Eddie, and he's having to chase down his own brother. But the problem here is, in fact, team orders are saying that they've got to try and pull this all back before the end of the day, and I've got a feeling that maybe Damiano Cunego is trying to think about two wins back-to-back, because I've got a feeling that this young man could stay in the group, which will certainly splinter on the last few kilometres up towards the summit, and he's certainly got the acceleration to get himself a second win at the Giro.
Well, looking now at the leader, heading into Gabba. 16 minutes was his biggest advantage, so he had his head. He got the Intergiro sprint at Formazzi di Bologna. He also went over the top of the Carpinelli, well clear of the field. Wegmann went over the top in second place there, 10 minutes behind, doing a battle with Alexander Moos in the King of the Mountains. So we could see a swing back to Wegmann in the leader's jersey in the King of the Mountains, which is green, by the way, in the Giro d'Italia.
Stefano Garzelli down there also looking pretty comfortable. He's also
seen much from him at all yet, have we?
He's also a rider, I think, who's looking to ride himself into form here at the Giro. But you can see the dedication of Team Saeco on the front there. They know that they've got a very good chance of getting themselves the pink jersey here this afternoon. And, of course, another stage victory after the one that opened up their account with Damiano Cunego. This is a beautiful part of the world we're going through here, through the Bologna Apennines. Not all that difficult, but I do think we'll have a serious sorting out over the last 10 kilometres. And Renzo Mazzolini, I think that tells it all. It's been a very long, hard chase, but he knows that over the last few kilometres, that main field is really going to turn up the notches.
Well, he has been away for 135 kilometres, and it looks like he's agreed now. It's curtains for him. Remember, the big climb is just ahead, which will take us up to the line. And there's an awful lot of riders here now feeling they're in with a chance. Just 50 seconds. For him. We just heard, by the way, the first retirement of the Giro d'Italia. Jürgen van der Velle from the Chocolat Jacques team from Belgium becomes the first man out of the tour.
So there's Mazzolini being chased by a Mazzolini, because Eddie Mazzolini is still on the front end of the main field. The race referee just sitting out of the car there, trying to see how quickly the main field is coming back. And as soon as he sees that gap go to around about the 30-second mark, he will move all of the cars and the motorbikes out of the gap. Pulling back there is always an indication that there is the main field. And I would say, Phil, that is not very much more than 30 seconds now.
No, that's about right. And as you can see now, the road's starting to kick up a little bit here as we get on the lower slopes of the climb up to the finish. Not an easy end to today's stage at all. It's been a long way, too, at 120 miles as we head up towards the highest point in the Apennines here in Bologna. There's the main field. And now we'll know how the strong men are feeling today as they start to come through, because they're going to want to make an impression today. There will be timed gaps at the finish. There's no doubt about that. Here's the catch, more or less, bye-bye. Been a good break, though. He went out at 38. He's been caught with around about 19 kilometres to go, something like that.
I think he's saying ciao mama, because he knows the writing's on the wall, because there is the main field, and it's interesting to see that it is very red on the front of that peloton, and that is Team Saeco. This is where we're heading to now over the final few kilometres as we start to tilt up towards the skies and the finish line there at Corno alla Scala, a very difficult climb. But not the steep in gradient. It's really made that little bit more difficult by the fact that it's a long climb up to the finish. There's the catch. And look how dedicated Team Saeco are. And almost the whole of the team is on the front end of the peloton.
Yeah, you're right. Petacchi doesn't seem to be too prominent right now. Well, Saeco here. They are the champions from last year's Giro d'Italia. Let's see what they can do this time around.
Castellano, the organiser of the Giro, just out of the top of the car there. There's the catch. Slipping back through the main field, the one or two riders will say well done. And all he's got to try and do now is survive and make sure that he can stay in the main field up towards the finish. But that field now, Phil, I think, is really starting to be put under pressure. There's Gilberto Simoni, surrounded by his men, looking very comfortable here as they start to set themselves up for what could be an early assault by Gilberto Simoni on the pink jersey.
And there's Cunego, too, wearing that Ciccolino points leader's jersey at the moment. He looks very, very strong. Riding last man of the team, that could be an indicator that they're trying to get him up to the top first. But they're taking control of this. Garzelli's team also trying to make an impression. I really do feel that Garzelli is going to have to show us something today to prove that he's in this race big time this year.
Also riding near the front there in the pale blue jersey of Gerolsteiner was David Rebellin. He too, well, look at that. Over the last 2 or 3 kilometres, the numbers have been dramatically reduced in that main field. And I wouldn't think Alessandro Petacchi or Mario Cipollini are going to be there.
Well, that looks like a pretty strong move here. Just starting to go clear. This looks like the long finish. Not, I thought it was Charlie Wagelius for a moment, but it isn't. It's his teammate, the Colpack teammate, Leonardo Giordani, I think it is, trying to go clear.
Well, Giordani, a former world champion a couple of years ago. That was at the under 23 level, and that was when the event was in Verona, where the world championships are going to be this year. In fact, somebody's leapt out of the pack behind him as well. So two riders on the attack. Not at all ruffling the feathers, Phil, of Team Saeco, who look completely and utterly in control here. They're not going to be worried about this. They don't want to panic, because these are the early attacks that I don't really think are going to go too far off the front.
Nice to see that Loda there, Nicola Loda, who was a teammate of Mazzolini, now back in the pack, and I think has just been tailed off the back of that pack, is trying to finish off what his teammate started. He's gone up there to join Giordani.
Well, they've only got about 15 seconds advantage over the front end of the main field, but you know, Team Saeco, I think today, are the team that are going to try and blow this race apart. It's a little bit of a difficult thing, because Gilberto Simoni wants to win the Giro d'Italia again, but he has to make sure that he doesn't do it too early on. There's Julio Perez there. Now, that's a bit strange to see him riding at the back, because I thought he was a man who's also got a very good chance of getting a stage win up here at the mountaintop.
His life at the back here, and it looked a little bit like Robin McEwen there, was sitting up and pedalling up the climb to the finish. His job done for the day. As we continue the pressure here from Leonardo Giudani, and in fact the former under-23 world champion has got rid of Loda by the look of it, and he's going for it now. It's everything or nothing, because the pack are not that far behind, but he is making progress, and that is Loda in the distance, so he's dropped him.
Well, he's opened up a slight gap, but it's going to be very difficult, I think, for somebody like Giordani to ride off the front and break the stranglehold. In fact, as they come round that corner, there is the main field just breathing down his neck. Not at all any panic on board Team Saeco, who seem to be the big armada. The difficult thing about trying to win the race like the Giro d'Italia, though, is using too much energy too early on. That's the damage that's being done at the back end of the main field. Riders are now very rapidly starting to get tailed off. And I thought I saw Stefano Garzelli there, but I can't believe that he's in difficulty.
This is Thomas Vaitkus here, Lithuanian rider, pretty good track rider. He'll be part of the Lithuanian track team too for the upcoming Olympic Games. And just like Brad McGee, who's doing similar, he's got three targets this year. As I said earlier, he's got the Tour de France to come in July, and then he wants to go for the World Pursuit Championship and Team Pursuit at the Olympic Games. That's a tough call, I think, but he's off to a great start in the first ambition. As we now see here, the gentle pace making by the peloton. They're just stamping up this climb. There's still quite a few kilometres from the summit. And this is a counter move now. And see what we can have. Formaggio Piave trying to get away here now. It's just 107 is Giuseppe Miraglia.
These are all just little flurries of attack as he's taken over Giordani, moved himself off into the lead. But the big pressure at the front end of the main field, because this is the first real showdown of the men who want to win the Giro d'Italia. This is not where the race is going to be won this afternoon, but it certainly is a place where we'll see which of the strong men are already in form before we go to the big mountains, once we get up to the top of the peninsula and go right across the top of Italy and through the Dolomites.
And still Saeco getting control of what is a rapidly dwindling peloton here.
Brad McGee is still very much to the front now. That's quite a surprise, because McGee is not really one of the best climbers in the world. But this group, you can see, has been reduced to around about 50 riders. So that's an indication that Brad McGee is not going to give up that pink jersey quite so easily. Let's not forget, at the start of the day, he held on to an advantage of 32 seconds. And that might well be enough to stay in pink for one more day.
11 kilometres to go, a little less than 7 miles. That's an awful long way. That sharp hairpin left there heralds really the start of the climb now. It's unforgiving all of the way to the top. And Miraglia is the first man to feel the pain of this climb. But the tempo being set by Saeco, they clearly have a plan. Now, whether it's for Simoni or Cunego, we're yet to find out. But Brad McGee was riding best of the rest there, sitting on the back wheel of the boys in red. I don't think Brad's got the ambition of leading this tour all the way, because he's very suspect in the mountains, but he's going to test himself today, that's for sure.
Well, he's never really performed exceptionally in the mountains, but over the last 12 months, he's actually lost a little bit of weight, around about 2 or 3 kilos, and he claims to have actually brought from Australia to Europe a dietitian to look after his diet, because he's had lots of peaks and troughs in his career throughout the year, and he believes that the reason for that is because of his diet. And he's actually very much monitored his diet and his intake over the last few months, and he's trying to make himself a slightly more consistent bike rider. But it's always very difficult trying to make somebody into a climber. There's Igor Astrolor on the far side. He's not enjoying this climb at all, and he too is starting to lose a little bit of pace off what is becoming now, Phil, a very select group of riders.
Yes, Astrolor showing his world championship bands off there as the cars move over the top. It's never a great feeling, that. Looks like Raffaele Illiano here has also dropped back into the pack from Selle Italia. And there's Julio Perez not climbing like the king of the mountains he was in this race, is he?
No, he certainly is not on form at all here in the Giro at the start, but that's very often the case. Let's not forget, this is the first week of racing. This is the first big mountain the riders will have to taste, and very often it catches a lot of riders out. But one team has not been caught out here at all is Team Saeco, who are still on the front end of that group, and again reducing the numbers in this group, which is now turning out to be really the heads of state of the Giro d'Italia in the first few days of racing.
That's right, 4 days in, the first big challenge today, which will give us the indicator as to who are going to start making a real challenge when we get down to the tough tail of this race this year. Hard climbs and the Dolomites still to come. All the cheers still going here on the climb for the one rider at the front, Maraglia. Now you can see how this climb begins to bite. Now we've left the town below us as we continue to go up the mountain, right to the summit, highest point in the Bologna Apennines, remember. 10 kilometres still to climb, and Maraglia is setting the pace.
Well, the signs all over the road there, Forza Simone, so I think we got an idea just exactly who they're cheering on there, Vai GB. And that is also for the man who is in around about third or fourth position, that line of red-clad riders there. Gilberto Simoni has got all of his riders on the front end of the main field. In fourth position on Simoni's wheel, though, is Damiano Cunego, who's got a very good chance of getting himself a crack at the pink because he's ahead of Simoni in the overall classification at the start of today.
Last man on this group, and looking as though he won't be there much longer, is Gianni Fallazin, the Italian, on Gerolsteiner, the German team. It's a very good team this year. It's having a great season. The likes of David Rebellin and Olaf Pollock is certainly keeping them flying their colours high at the moment. I was going to say the pavement artists have been at work, but it's more like the field artists at the moment. Very good wine, Lambrusco.
Looking down here, Gilberto Simoni now I think is probably thinking about stamping his authority on the front end of this team, because he may well be a little bit worried about the performances of his teammate Damiano Cunego over the last couple of months, because in basically the last 10 days of racing, Cunego has himself 6 victories, including one stage here at the Giro d'Italia. Muraglia still holding on to a very slim advantage and not really looking like a man who's going to cause a great surprise. That's around about 5 seconds over the front end of the main field, which is very much dominated by Saeco. The man who's been doing an awful lot of the work there was Eddie Mazzolini, but they still have a very solid squad there. Perez seems to have recovered because he's moving up into around about 10th position. So he now is thinking about a crack at a mountaintop finish if he can.
Now here's a little look at life of the boys who are surviving, but only just at the moment at the back of the race. Geert Verheyen, Chocolat Jacques. They've lost one man today in Jürgen van der Wallen.
That's Gianni Farazin as well, just in front of him, looking to be very much on the rivet, trying to stay in contact with this group. As we get closer to the summit, though, that group is going to start to splinter, and we get a chance to see if anybody's showing any signs of weakness. Number 42 down there, by the way, is a little Colombian rider on the Chocolat Jacques team. That's Maurizio Ardila. And he, according to some of the riders on the squad, is a very good climber, and he's a man we need to keep a very close watch on.
So the field continues and the kilometres slowly tick off. This rider's tried to stay around. I don't know his gears there, Paul. It looks like he might have a 25 back sprocket on this bike just now. But Muraglia, forget the advantage of 10 seconds. They're right there and they're pulling him back. And now are we going to see a counter-attack or will they continue? Just to keep the tempo going nicely here, those who can stay can stay. 8 kilometres to climb and they're all together.
Still Saeco, there's Gilberto Simoni in third position. Fourth position there is Damiano Cunego. There's Eddie Mazzolini. As we get a gruppo compacto, this is Gianni Farazin. He's at the back end of the group trying to stay in contact as we look further forward there. And he certainly isn't doing that. There's Vladimiro Belli just on the far side in the blue and pink jersey of Panaria. There is Popovic. Now, he's also got a very good chance of getting himself into the pink jersey here this afternoon, and he's a great favourite for a lot of people to actually take out the overall win, because he's done so well over the last couple of seasons at the Giro d'Italia that one day or another, I do feel certain he's going to win it.
Just looking at Cunego there, he'll be happy in this region because he won the Tour of the Apennines in April, it's last month. There he is. Interesting character, isn't he? Such a small, dapper little lad. Looks as though he's up for the fight as well, wearing the Ciclamino jersey as points leader currently.
David Rebellin just coming up on the left-hand side there in the pale blue jersey. Cocchioli. is Eddie Mazzolini with the dark hair and the dark glasses there, as you get a chance to see what it's like at the back end of the main field. A lot of these riders really just struggling to try and stay in contact. So Senka on the back.
There's Gazzelli too. Gazzelli looking as though he might be in a position today. He knows the men to mark. It's the balding man in the yellow jersey as he sits there on the tail of Saeco. This is a very quick pace now because these boys have slipped it onto the top chainring here. This is superb pacemaking here by Tonti. He's the newcomer here for Saeco in the Giro, and he was the pacemaker yesterday as well when they got a good result with Cunego. He's doing the same now, and maybe it'll be same again at the finish. Cunego is certainly itching to have a go.
So I tell you what, Saeco are dishing out some serious pain here as we go through 7 kilometres to go. That's Sylvester Schmidt in second position. But these guys really are turning up the screws here. Mazzolini, you see now, has moved up into third place. He's getting ready to take over. I think they're going to just try and eliminate as many riders as possible. And they've done a marvellous job over the last 25 kilometres because, as you can see, they've really reduced that main field down to around about 45 men. And they still are trying to set the win up there this afternoon, I would say, for Gilberto Simoni, who I think has to stamp his authority on the team to say, OK, guys, Cunego's been pretty good leading up to the Giro, but don't forget I'm the boss.
Well, that's the way it goes when you're the big man on the team. We're heading up to top out at just on 5,000 feet at the finishing line. And just over 6 kilometres away now under the regulations. Helmets can now come off as the climb is more than 5 kilometres long and it takes you directly to the line. That's what the rule says.
That's Muralia just getting rid of his helmet. Still staying in contact with this group who are being led completely and utterly here by a team that has only come to the Giro d'Italia for one thing, and that's to win the race with Gilberto Simoni. They don't really have any sprinters on board, although they've had some success already with Damiano Cunego, but look at the speed they are ripping up this mountain. Queuing up though behind Simoni, you can see Stefano Gazzelli. I'm not sure what his form is like right now because he's had a fairly quiet start to the season. He just started to ride himself into form a month before the Tour. And now he will also be hoping that he can stay on the wheel of Gilberto Simoni as we once again get a glimpse at the back end of the pack with 6 kilometres to go. You know, Saeco are not asking anybody for any help at all here. They just want to rip this place to pieces.
I tell you what, they're actually climbing here in the region of 14 to 15 miles an hour, which is an incredibly fast speed. And that's what's causing these riders to string out. And that peloton has been shrinking by the kilometre. And it's all under the impetus here of the riders in red. Fantastic pacemaking by them, with Mazzolini now stretching them out again. But the two important men, Simoni and Cunego, for me, are waiting to pounce. And Gazzelli knows it because he's right there. But most impressive for a so-called non-climber is Brad McGee.
Well, Brad McGee still there. So is Philippe Gilbert as well. I caught a glimpse of him just a few moments ago. He's doing a very good job. And in fact, the other rider in there for FDJ.com is Nicolas Fritsch. He's, in fact, just disappearing off the back of the group. Now you can see a lot of riders moving forward. They're starting to feel the itch and the power go out of the pacemaking of Team Saeco. Moving up there, you can see the big, huge Ukrainian rider there from the team of Denadi.
I'm just looking at the field here now. I think that Tonti has just about stretched himself to the limit now. That's why they've closed up, because in fact Tonti's running out of steam, and it looks like one of the Saeco riders has just run out of steam now. The pace is beginning to tell here. We're looking at Nicolas Fritsch from the FDJ.com team. He's also on his way backwards under the pressure. This is why we're heading up towards 5 kilometres to go. If there's anybody with the strength to attack, they won't leave it much longer to completely shatter this leading group.
There's Honchar just moving up. He's the Ukrainian national champion. Stefano Gazzelli actually seems to be riding fairly comfortably there on the wheel of Gilberto Simoni. And if this is a group sprint towards the top of this climb, Garzelli's got a fairly good chance of taking it out, because he's got a very good acceleration at the top of mountains like this. And he will have fairly good morale because he got himself a stage victory just about 2 weeks ago in the Tour of Romandy. Cunego is still riding very close to the front end of the main field as well.
New pacemaker now is Leonardo Bettignoli for Saeco. The other pacemakers have suddenly decided enough was enough. They've done their job well and they will just ride into the finish now, living to fight another day. Today being tomorrow, of course, on this 3-week race. Just looking down there to see if I can see Brad McGee. We saw him earlier. He was pretty close to the lead as he seems to have lost a little bit of ground on the climb. Could well be losing the jersey too, because it's only half a minute and a lot of riders can challenge for it.
Well, that could also mean that the bonuses are going to be very important, because if Brad McGee doesn't stay in this group, the overall lead could either go to Yaroslav Popovic or Damiano Cunego, because Cunego is still very much there.
Oh, well, anything goes on the mountain. As we wait now for the leaders, here they come. It's all Saeco. Just 3 days of the Giro, really, out on the highway, they've become the team to beat. They've set themselves up as that manner anyway. The field is now thinning out rather dramatically at the back of the race there. It was good to see that Marcio Brusagin of Fassa Bortolo was surviving in here. He's an amazing bike rider.
Well, he's one of those bike riders who is always there, promising to come up with a big performance one day or another, but he's never actually managed to get himself the big win. There's David Revelin with the bleached blonde hair on the inside of the corner there. He too is in great form this season and may well be looking for a very good Giro d'Italia. After all, he's dominated the World Cup since the start of the season.
Yes, he's established himself in that for sure. And there's here's Bamagate. There he is. Now he's in trouble here. And he's desperately trying to hang on, but this has been a huge effort by Bradley McGee, and he's a great fighter. He started well, he marked well, he couldn't hold the pacemaking though of Tonti, and he's still more or less just in contention here. Now, every time this road eases slightly, McGee is going to pedal back in.
Marlon Perez was the rider from Colombia, Selle Italia, just behind him. Now, he mustn't panic at this point here at all, Brad McGee, because he's got a very good chance of riding himself back into his rhythm. But he's never really been a great mountain climber. He's a man who's come from a very big pedigree on the track, trying to prove that he can be a good road rider, as many of the big pursuit riders of the past have been able to do. But once they get to the big high mountains, that's where they find the limit. Now, there is a rather interesting hairdo for our man Pavel Tonkov, a former winner of the Giro d'Italia. And I think a very relaxed, another of those strange riders who keeps announcing his retirement, but then adding another 12 months to his career.
He's always loved this race. He won it in 1996, one of only two Russian winners. Gilberto was the first. Well, you've got to take your hat off to this man. Just watch how he suffers. He will not relinquish his position without a real fight here, Brad McGee. Terrific riding, losing a bit through the trees as we're getting up high into the woods now. And still the work being done here. And Tonti has got himself back on the front there, but this is an attack now.
Good move by Fonak. Trying to put themselves off the front end of this group. And this is a very solid move coming off here by Marco Fettonani.
Yes, it is too. And you might tell me who he is, Paul, because I've never heard of him. But there he is, Marco Fettonani. He's done well to get off because of the pace they were doing. Now, this could start the reaction that perhaps Saeco have been waiting for now, because he's taken the pressure off them. Now it's up to them, and here comes the drive again to put him right back in the pack.
Well, this is something that Brad McGee is not going to enjoy either. These accelerations, I think, will announce the departure of Bradley McGee from this group, because McGee, I think, was able to stay in the group while they were riding at one steady, consistent pace. But these consistent accelerations that the climbers can produce are not good for a man who rides on a nice rhythm of his own. So there is Brad McGee. I think there was a gap there.
There is a gap.
So it looks as if it's going to be a change in the overall classification. And if we were to stop the race right now, it would go to Yaroslav Popovic. But look at this, Cunego. He's riding the position, I think, here, Phil, as team defender. He's gone away there with Eddie Mazzolini, who's gone right across that gap. But this will put pressure on the others and will put pressure on riders like Popovic if they want to get themselves into the pink jersey this evening.
It's a perfect situation here because, well, I was about to say they could ease a couple of riders away, but in fact it's been shut down and we're all back together, and Eddie is back in the driving seat at 3 kilometres to go. All uphill, remember, and this could sort of, and this looks like a move here from Cunego and Mazzolini. Well, hardly had they been clear, and they pushed on, and Cunego is sensing a win, and now Mazzolini has eased them back.
Well, this is a bit of a surprise, because I thought the day was for Gilberto Simoni, but this could be the birth of a brand new star of Italian cycling. Damiano Cunego has gone off the front, and it's going to mean that everybody else has got to chase, and it's Popovic in person who is now trying to nail back the gap to this man here. Look at this, he looked over his shoulders, watch this acceleration, he's surrounded by his own teammates, and the way this young kid dances on the pedals is absolutely phenomenal. Not only can he climb, but he can sprint as well.
Look at the size of his thighs here, for the shape of his body. He's a small rider, 22 years of age, and Gilberto Simoni. Well, this is a gamble because it looks like he's trying to go after Cunego, his own teammate, and he is. And Popovic isn't looking so good down there just now. Once you start looking at the ground, it usually means you're under pressure. And the gap has opened, and now we have one terrific Saeco tandem.
Well, I don't think it's going to be a tandem for very much longer because, in fact, there was a gap there immediately. Gilberto Simoni got out of the saddle, put time between himself and his own teammate, Damiano Cunego. But look at this. What they're doing is putting a lot of the other contenders under serious pressure on the first mountain of this year's Giro d'Italia. And one man struggling to stay in contact there is Stefano Garzelli. The man doing the pacemaking, though, is Popovic. He obviously feels he's got a very good chance, but look at the way Simoni dances all over those pedals. It just makes this mountain look so easy.
He's running a pretty low gear, too. There is Garzelli. Piccoli also here, just peeping in and out on the left of the picture, is Andrea Noe. Noe loves the Giro d'Italia, hardly rides well anywhere else, but he always rides well in this race. And he's there again. Now, Gilberto Simoni here, heading up to the highest finisher of the tour so far on the Corno Al Scala.
And he's around about 12 seconds behind his own teammate Damiano Cunego in the overall classification at the start of the day. That was David Rebellin as well, who was going off the back of the group. He's struggling to stay in contention. Cunego now, I think, is just going to have to sit up and wait for the rest of the group and just sit there with his own teammates while they allow Gilberto Simoni to be chased by all the other big names. But this really is throwing down the gauntlet on only day three on the open road.
Last year's champion looking now to what could be an early lead in the Giro. There is Cunego. Looks as though he's under pressure, but not out of it by any means. The crowd just cottoning on that this is Gilberto Simoni here. And he's choosing today to make an early impression on the Giro d'Italia. A little bit too early? Well, we won't know yet, will we?
I don't think he can ride himself into the pink jersey here this afternoon because he started 47 seconds behind Bradley McGee and around about 15 seconds behind these two riders here. Popovic, who is in second place in the overall classification, and, of course, Damiano Cunego. On the far side there, Giuliano Figueras, he too is starting to look fairly confident. And this is a rider just in the blue and white jersey there who I'm a bit surprised to still see in contact. That was Dario Cioni.
Cioni's ridden a good race so far. Ex-mountain biker, speaks fluent English because he was born in Great Britain, but he's very much Italian. Looking down now at the leading riders again, that's Noe. They're hanging on now to Cunego's wheel. Pelazzotti, I think, was also getting across to him. Popovic, 12th and 3rd in his last two tours, is a man for the Giro, and he said he wants to win this year, and he's going to have to do something now to limit his losses, because the biggest, most important rider in the tour, last year's champion Simoni, is going clear. Now, Paul, you said he may not get pink. Well, he's pulling time, big time, out of Brad McGee, so his main rivals for pink jersey now could be his own teammate here, Cunego.
Well, he's got 15 seconds deficit on Cunego at the start of the day and, of course, about the same on Popovic. Look at the position here of Stefano Garzelli. He really is suffering, and there is the 15-second advantage. So I may well be completely wrong. He could be riding himself into the pink jersey.
It's not often on television you get some idea of just how steep the climb is. It's very difficult to portray, but I think that shot of Garzelli gave you some idea how this road does kick up. It's going to be a real tough ascent now, and they're losing ground steadily here.
Cunego, though, is still looking very comfortable. He's just sitting there. He's allowing the other riders to do the pacemaking. And although he was in a spot of bother when he was caught by his team leader, Gilberto Simoni, he now actually seems to have recovered. And he's just sitting there very comfortably, allowing them to do the chasing after his own team leader.
The other rider in that select group, by the way, was the Penaria rider, Giuliano Figueras. Although he looks as though he may not be there now. He's not in this shot anyway. Piccoli is. Oh, this is Figueras right here. In fact, I think he's gone clear. No, he's still with that. He's still with the group of Popovic.
Well, Simoni now riding away from the rest of the group. But just look at the defensive riding there being done by Cunego. He's got himself a stage win under his belt this year in the Giro. There is Pelazzotti moving up into fourth place. And I tell you what, riding like a champion on the front is Yaroslav Popovic. He's not worried at all about the presence of little Damiano Cunego there at all. He's decided he wants to ride himself up to the towards the leader there, and he's going to have to do something very solid because he's already losing 24 seconds to Gilberto Simoni. We have no news at all on the position of Bradley McGee, so it could be there will be a massive change in the overall classification. Right now, if we stop the race, the man in the pink would be Gilberto Simoni, and he's now riding into the last kilometre of this climb.
And he doesn't look like a guy who's losing time just now. In fact, he's gaining time over everybody here. At 1 kilometre to go, we're just up to the snow line. 1,471 metres is the finishing line today. And Simoni on stage three of the Giro d'Italia. And when there's still 167 of the 168 riders who started in this event, is riding towards the pink jersey. And Garzelli, I'm not too sure where he is. Oh, he's still with the group, because with those shots, when they tighten in, it's usually a sign they've been left. But Garzelli now is being left to do all of the pacemaking, and Cunego will not be arguing about that. Here's Cunego here. He's riding with Pelizzotti, and up front is Frigoras, and they must be the next three on the road now, and they've got Popovic in trouble.
Well, Popovic has popped. I'm really surprised to see that, because just a few moments ago, he was the man on the front dictating the pace in this group. The pacemaking now has been taken up by Figueras. Cunego is riding very comfortably in second place there. All he's waiting for is a chance to see the finishing line, and he's going to try and make it 1-2 for Saeco.
The lonely figure now, a little sly glance over his shoulder there for Gilberto Simoni. He will see no one. This has been a significant climb, but I have a feeling that now Cunego is free of most of those riders. The gap is closing down. A little bit of puffing and blowing there by Simoni. Nearly 6 hours, a long, long day today to cover 120 miles. They're not that far behind. There's Pelizzotti, and there is the long approach to the line now, but there's no doubt who's going to win. It's a question of who is going to lead at the end of stage three here at the Corno Al Scala. Little bit of an effort now required from Gilberto Simoni. It's going to be seconds in it. This is the chase group, four of them lining up. In the distance there is Simoni.
A great job of work being done by Damiano Cunego, just sitting there allowing all of the others to try and get themselves the gap, but they're not eating into the advantage of Gilberto Simoni. Although they are in the same straightaway, it is very much foreshortened by the camera lens.
But I think they have closed the gap here, and I think the effort has come from Frigoras and Pelizzotti. It certainly hasn't come from Damiano Cunego. He's done nothing wrong in chasing down his teammate at all. But as you can see now, we're just tickling the snow line, just coming up towards the end of the month of May. Very inhospitable place in the winter, but it is a great ski station.
Garzelli coming back as well there, just around the corner. This is a very long final kilometre. Although it's measured out at 1,000 metres, it feels a lot longer than that to all of these riders here. Out of the saddle once more, Gilberto Simoni is definitely going to get the stage win, but for him, will he have enough time to get himself the pink jersey?
Well, a huge effort required, because I think Simoni went perhaps a little bit early here. He hasn't looked that fluid in the last kilometre or so. He's going to be happy enough to see the line, I think, but it's a big effort for him. It's certainly a win for Saeco, the second in as many days, and that's what counts. Gilberto Simoni, the clock starts now. He looks tired. It's a question of whether he's done enough to get pink as well. There's the sprint now for second place. It's going to be between Pelizzotti, Figueras and Cunego.
And that was Garzelli.
And look at that, Cunego's taking second as well. A 1-2 for Saeco.
And only 15 seconds. And with the game of the time bonuses, it's going to be very close as to whether or not Cunego is going to be the new leader in the overall classification. I think he's done enough to do it, but it's going to be very close indeed.
Well, I'll tell you what, one thing's for sure, with another second place backed up to a second and a win so far, he is now into the slot nice and clearly as the points leader of this race anyway. Well, it looks as though over the line now with the chase group of Garzelli, they've all conceded time. This is going to be seen as a good day. Is this Brad McGee's group? Yes, it is. He's a little bit further down the mountain. You can see the clock still counting here.
Well, Brad McGee, I think, has done a pretty good ride there. A minute and a half since Gilberto Simoni crossed the line. It's going to be very tight, I think, between Simoni and Cunego as to who is going to be the leader in the overall classification. But I think Gilberto Simoni has got enough time in hand to take himself the overall lead, and he feels very confident. This is what he wanted to do today. He wanted to stamp his authority not only on the Giro, but I think on the team as well, getting himself a very illustrious win here just under the snow line. Certainly makes you feel very cold on a stage like this. That's the order over the finishing line. Simoni ahead of Cunego by 15 seconds. Pelizzotti at 16 seconds. Popovic coming in at the tail end of that group. But Gilberto Simoni just showing his fill once again. Once the roads tilt upwards, he really does like to fly.
I think he might even feel a little bit relieved here. I think he will get now by about 15 seconds, the Maglia Rosa, that'll give him the lead he wants. And of course, a little message going back to his teammate, to Damiano Cunego, that the big man is still the boss. In fact, 13 seconds the official gap. Popovic third. He slips one place, Pellizzotti, and out now goes Brad McGee. He conceded in the end over 2 minutes.
Well, you know, what was impressive to me was Brad McGee stayed with that group for a very long time. And even he, I think, was nurturing hopes of staying in the pink jersey for a little bit longer, but that wasn't to be.
On to stage four now. The riders going back through a town they've already passed through, Preta Terme, onto the Civitella in the Val di Chiana. Another long day here, 120 miles being followed by this stage of 114 or 184 kilometres. A little bit more friendly, though, the gradients now as we move on towards the Valle di Chiana.
Petacchi here already. At the side of the road.
Now, this is strange because that doesn't look like a mechanical to me.
No, he's got some kind of a problem here. In fact, Marco Velo is alongside him there, but I cannot imagine what is wrong with Alessandro Petacchi here at all. It could be some kind of crack. It could be that somebody has actually rear-ended him. This can happen sometimes in the main field. The rider just rides into you from behind with his handlebars, and it causes an instantaneous kind of a cramp, but this does not look very good at all for Alessandro Petacchi.
Well, I've really no idea. Here we are. We can have a look now. Well, you could be right, Paul. He could have been hit from behind.
He's actually bowed over there in pain. You see, he's just grabbing his thigh, just inside the back of the thigh. I think what has happened here is somebody's actually ridden into the back of him, almost as if you whack somebody in the thigh and give him a dead leg, and he's obviously in a certain amount of pain.
Well, Velo is normally his lead-out man, very sharp to spot his captain in trouble. Anyway,
well,
he's going away again, but he's got a bit of work to do. And this is the stage that would have suited him, of course. I'm not too sure now, but more the question is he going to get to the finish? Well, let's get back up to the action now. As we move on again now, the sign that Fassa Bortolo have got the men up here. There he is. He's back in the thick of it now and looking for a victory here, but I wonder what was going on there.
Well, I think we'll only find out after the race is over, but the rain has certainly started to come down a fraction here, and it's going to make this running very dangerous indeed. Team Fassa Bortolo now inside of 3 kilometres to go to the finish, trying to set up Alessandro Petacchi here for win number two. Mario Cipollini's teammate is moving forward there, now does.
We're looking here now, and Cipollini, we've seen nothing of him at all. We certainly wouldn't have seen any of him yesterday, of course, as we're now seeing the rain just loosening off the roads a bit here, which is not going to make for a very good sprint down in Civitella.
Looks like Lombardi on the front there on the left-hand side. A bit of argy-bargy going on. A lot of shoulders moving around left and right. Cipollini is not too far away there. He'll be looking to try and get himself a win. He wants to try and extend that win of his in the Giro. Now there's Cipollini with the white helmet on.
The question is, just is Cipollini up to the Giro d'Italia now? I think this will be his last one. He is the record holder with the stage wins, but he's finally the new man on the block now. And we do now know that, in fact, Alessandro Petacchi did crash on the Poggio di Sugame after 71 kilometres. And what we saw was the aftermath of the fall when he seemed to stop in pain. But he's back in the race now, and he's challenging for the win. Looks like big Magnus Bankstedt's up here as well.
He'll be challenging for the win too. He'll enjoy these weather conditions. It's very cold. There's Lombardi. He's right on the wheel of Naudos, the man who last year was not very popular with Mario Cipollini, and it's amazing how the sport of cycling works out. One day you're an enemy, the next day you're an ally, and that's certainly the case here for Domino Vacanzi, trying to get control, trying to break the rhythm of the Fassa Bortolo lead out, because if you allow Fassa Bortolo to get themselves lined out into a big line on the front end of the main field, it is very, very difficult to beat Alessandro Petacchi.
Well, there's riders moving to the front now, but I didn't see Mario Cipollini trying to get in on this one. This isn't the finish. Remember, he crashed out on a stage like this last year. It was too slippery. And that was when Robbie McEwen popped out and won the day. And McEwen's much more a better bet here as they begin to fan out. Big Magnus Bankstedt here looking for somebody to follow, but he's finding himself washed away here in the sprint now. And Cadamuro is the Donardi rider down there. Now the sprint has started, and there's no Cipollini there. He's too far down. There he is. as they start to go now. It looks like we've also got a move coming as well from Olaf Pollock, and a familiar sprint, and the lead out again is coming from the boys of Fassa Bortolo. Sean, there's been a crash, and that looks like Cipollini has gone down. And there's a multiple pile up there, but it's left them clear at the front. And Alessandro Petacchi, crash injuries and all, he's taking on Robbie McEwen, and Petacchi gets his second win.
You can't beat that, man. You just cannot beat Alessandro Petacchi at the moment. If you give him a straight run at the finishing line, he has got such an incredible turn of speed over 400 metres. But this is the crash at 200 metres to go. And I feel that one of the riders who went down very hard down there was Mario Cipollini. That's him.
It's a case of deja vu, isn't it, Paul? Because this is what happened last year, and it wasn't long before Cipollini was on his way home. And I wonder now, he's gone down with Popsiev there, the Ukraine.
And I think it was actually one of his teammates who took him down there. If we get a chance to look at the slow motion, I think he was on the wheel of his teammates, Andrus Oes, and he went down very heavily indeed. No control at all, and he banged himself down onto the ground. And this is the damage. This, in fact, is Tonti, who was also involved in that crash, and he actually went right up into the air. He's snapped his forks there.
Well, maybe that was the cause of the crash, the snapping of the forks. But we'll have a look if we can again. But there is Cipollini. In fact, we can't see the front of his ankle, but it looks quite nastily gashed at the moment. And he's probably in need of some stitches. The irony is that the man he once blamed for causing an accident, Nasdux here, is now his teammate and has gone back to help him.
That's the irony of the sport. There you can see Tonti's bike is completely snapped there. There's the blood on Mario Cipollini's ankle there. Confirmation of the win. Let's not forget Alessandro Petacchi getting himself win number two there. But let's have a look here if we can see. Right in the middle, you can see the lead out coming for Alessandro Petacchi there, but it's Auds who was actually looking over his shoulder to see where Mario Cipollini was. Cipollini was the first man to go down, and then one or two riders have gone right over the top of him, and I think somebody slid into Cipollini with a chain ring, and that's probably what caused the damage to his ankle.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. But that was... Well, I'm surprised only a handful of riders actually fell down there, but Cipollini got knocked around a bit while he was lying on the floor.
Yeah, Cipollini went down first.
He was down first, no question. I think he touched a wheel in front, perhaps. You know, as you get older, your reflexes slow down. I'm not saying that's what happened, but it's a possibility.
Well, I think it is. I think Cipollini's very much on the rivet here, and that is not going to be good for his morale. I only hope that he'll get up from that and ride on tomorrow's stage, because Cipollini sometimes can spit the dummy and decide to take his bicycle home. And I hope that's not the case, because if it is, it might be the last time we see Mario Cipollini at the Giro d'Italia.
Well, he's been a fantastic entertainer. I certainly hope it isn't, but age catches up with everybody, and Petacchi, although he's 30 years of age, is the new man on the block here. Another stage win for him. And his teammates saluting there, because their job done to perfection. Let's have a look again.
Yes, it is. You see, there's Oates there in the middle, was looking over his shoulder left and right. He probably heard Cipollini trying to communicate with him. Cipollini was caught on the wrong side, and that's the impact there that has caused the damage to Mario Cipollini's ankle. And he will certainly not feel very comfortable tomorrow morning when he gets out of
bed.
That
was unlucky. I mean, that rider desperately tried to avoid him by sliding his bike across, and it didn't work out.
Just look at that. The man who led out Alessandro Petacchi there in about 10th position in the white and blue jersey there, he's got his finger on the microphone to tell the team manager behind, we've got the win.
And that's before he crosses the line. But there you go. And he's again the man who's the loser on the day, Robbie McEwen, nearest camera. Another second place for Robbie. And the rain continues to come down here at the Val di Chiana. 114 miles. Pretty fast miles today. And as expected, in the end, a rather controversial, but no change in the overall. A sprint for Petacchi, and that the pink jersey staying on the shoulders of last year's winner, Simoni. 13 seconds advantage over second and third place.
Well, certainly not a great day, but for Gilberto Simoni, a day in the pink jersey, and a day he's been able to keep hold of the pink jersey. But once again, the road now heading out further up the continent.
So we stay in the start town overnight because Civitella, where we finish, is where we start today. 111 miles, 177 kilometres to Spalletta. And this is a sprinter's delight, and it could be another day for Petacchi. There's Spoleto, that's where we're headed to. And this is the peloton under pressure again now. And they're going to have to learn to break the tactics, I think, of Fassa Bortolo.
Well, I think that's what Acqua Saponi are trying to do, because they've got themselves a very good organisation on the front end of the main field. Gruppo Compacto, the whole of the main field together. The winds and rain of yesterday have disappeared. The red helmets on the Aqua Saponi team here trying to lead out either of their two sprinters. They got two very fast men on board. One of them is Freddy Rodriguez, the other is Crescenzo D'Amore.
Cipollini, by the way, did take to the start, has been seen riding near the front, but he has had stitches, I believe, in his lower leg. There's the readers now as they're trying to sort this one out amongst themselves, but it's not organised this at all by Petacchi.
Oh no, Petacchi's team has certainly not got the organisation on the front end of the main field. That role really here belonging to Freddy Rodriguez's team, Aqua Saponi. They've got a very rapid line out on the front end of the main field. Naudos is there in third position. He may well have been given a free rein to ride his own race here this afternoon because Cipollini will not be mixing it with the rest of the pack. There is Petacchi in around about eighth position.
Well, Crescenzo D'Amore won the Intergiro, by the way, and he keeps his lead in that competition, but there hasn't been much in the way of breakaways at all today. This is a perfect sprinter's result heading into Spalletta, and Petacchi, surprising me, but doesn't seem to be organised at all here for this sprint. It could go almost any direction.
Well, Lombardi up there into second place. Petacchi is not in the first 10 at the moment, but I did just get a glimpse of him as they go inside 2 kilometres to go. A lot of arms and hands coming off the handlebars. Swinging off there, it looks as if it's one of the teammates of Freddy Rodriguez. Now, look at that. A few moments ago, there was no organisation by Alessandro Petacchi's team. Now there are three men on the front of the main field. There's Robbie McEwen.
And there's the 1 kilometre kite as they now run in. So they're about 58 seconds from the line right now. It's not as well organised, though, by Petacchi today. They've got three men there. Where's the lead-out man, Marco Velo?
Petacchi's in the top 10 there, but he seems to be a little bit far off this afternoon. No, he's around about 10th, so just a little bit too far back. He really needs to be on the wheel of his teammates, and they're now down to just one.
Well, there's an irony for you, Paul, because his teammates are totally disorganised today. They haven't got it together. Looks over his shoulder and looks straight into the face of McEwen. McEwen did not want the lead at this point at all now, as the FDJ riders start to come up as well. There's a little bit of shoulder punching going on too. Petacchi is out of this one, I think. There's Brad McGee on the far right of the stage, and Olaf Pollock is also here. This is going to be a very strange result today because the big sprinter is sitting it out. He is not going to come up on this one now as they line up for the finish. Marco Zanotti is the rider in the yellow, about third wheel off to the left of our picture. And now as they go to the line, McEwen is right in the thick of it and could win him. Pollock's coming late. McEwen hits the line first. Robbie McEwen gets the stage win, which has eluded him on two occasions so far this week. A very strange sprint indeed. Petacchi was not there.
There was no control at the front end of the main field. Nobody had the race completely and utterly lined up. Maybe Alessandro Petacchi had said to the teammates this afternoon, look, I just don't have the legs. Let's not forget he was involved in that nasty crash yesterday, and it can knock the stuffing out of a bike rider over the last few hundred metres. And this is the point here where you can just see Alessandro Petacchi moving up. I thought he'd recovered at this point, but then he decided it was just a little bit too dangerous. He was actually forced to slow down there. He's sitting up and allowing the guys at the front end to go on with the sprint. McEwen is amazing. There he's in fourth place. He dances around, moves from left to right, waits to see when the gap is going to open. And today, it was the day for the Australian.
Just over 25 miles an hour, nearly 41 kilometres today. Very quick stage indeed. The sprinters did have the day, and a credible sprint it was too by the Australian McEwen, who says he's come here to win stages and go home midway through the race. He won't go into the final mountains. There's the finish for you as he takes a very fast approach to the line. When he sees the line, and he's obviously without Alessandro Petacchi, he gets very annoyed when all the publicity goes the way of Petacchi, by the way. But McEwen now showing he is the best. A late run by Olaf Pollock, yet another second. Second in the prologue and a couple of seconds in the sprint, and he's really annoyed about that one. Bangs his handlebars there.
And Crescenzo D'Amore was pretty much up there as well, as was Freddy Rodriguez, who wasn't very far away at all. Rodriguez starting to ride himself a very consistent race. But Robbie McEwen, he certainly does like to rise to the occasion. He's a very consistent sprinter. And unlike Alessandro Petacchi, he never has anybody to lead him out. He has to do all the work himself.
There's the result for you. Same time for everybody. Pollock, Zanotti, the order on the line. Robbie McEwen gets the win. He's been here before, and the Australian never happier than when he is winning at stage of the bike race. No jersey awaits him, of course. There'll be no change overall at all after this fifth stage here. D'Amore keeps the Intergiro competition. Simoni stays in the pink for a third day. McEwen now has done enough to get himself into the points leader's jersey, though. There's the result. 13 seconds, the gap. Popovic hanging in there third. He finished third last year. He won't be forgetting that either. And it was third to Simoni. The big surprise, I think, is the continuing great form Damiano Cunego, as we now move on to stage six here. Onward we go from Spoleto to Valmontone, 164 kilometres, that's 103 miles, and one second category mountain along the way, but basically it's mid-term, and it's very early, in fact, rather. It will mean that we should see the bunch sprinters come into action again. Looking down from the helicopter there, as you can see, the weather not very friendly at all in these early days of the Giro d'Italia.
Very nasty weather, actually. You can see, though, once again, this incredible team. This team, Phil, I have to say, have changed over the last week of racing. Fassa Bortolo, a team that last year at the Giro d'Italia were riding as a team to put men to the top end of the overall classification, this year are just riding for one thing, and that is to try and get as many stage wins as possible for one Alessandro Petacchi. It's a team that's been completely and utterly built around him. There's nobody at all has got a chance of riding high in the overall classification, so all they can do on every flat stage is ride flat out for Alessandro.
The tail of the group, Coda del Gruppo. Is it miserable or what, as the rain is now quite torrential here? And the riders, just to see the gaps between the riders and the peloton, they're all trying to look for their own route here and not get their faces covered in the spray off the wheel in front. It's every man for himself. They are soaking wet today, but over roads like this, this is a very quick pace, and you've got to stay alert and sharp. A touch of wheels now and you'll slide on this road surface for a kilometre.
And the scary thing about this kind of condition as well is, it, in fact, if you do touch your brakes, they actually don't work in weather conditions like this. It takes a few seconds for the brake pads to actually bite in. So that's why you can see the slightly bigger gaps between the riders as they head into town now. This is an absolutely torrential downpour here as we head into the finishing town of Valmontone. And still a lot of riders from Fassa Bortolo on the front end of the main field. An arm just going up there. I think somebody's probably had a flat tyre.
Well, the only activity of the day really was came from Fortunato Baliani. He was away an awful long time. He managed to clean up a little bit along the route, but now he's back in the pack. At least I hope he's still in the pack. These are hazardous right-handers too under the narrow entry under that railway bridge. We're into town. And this time it looks to me as though organisation is back to normal here. That rider has come down, Zach Crescendo D'Amore, who has just fallen there. In fact, it's Pedregato, I think it was. But he must have slid on that corner into the tunnel. He looks okay, but he's out of the hunt for the sprint. Now, as I said, it's back to normal for the men from Fassa Bortolo. And the bottom of our picture there, Alessandro Petacchi looking for win three.
Well, he's got all of his men on the front end of the main field. This is Tossato, who's doing a fabulous job. A last-minute burst here coming from the world champion. This is the kind of move that could cause the surprise, especially in these kind of weather conditions. And he's got a good gap.
Well, that's a great move by Astoloa. And it's nice to see the world champion showing his jersey off. Hasn't had a chance to do that this year yet, but he has shown signs of good form. There's that little rise here. He must have been paying attention when he looked at his overnight contour route, and he's chosen that little rise to try and open the gap. The sprinters have got two left, one lead, and the third man is Petacchi. But he got the move. I'm not sure he's got the gap.
Well, he's got a gap. He's still got a gap of around about 30 or 40 bike lengths. All he needs now is a general slowing down at the front end of the main field. But it has put a lot of pressure on Fassa Bortolo as they come inside of the last kilometre. Tossato was the man doing most of the pacemaking, but I think the man taking over now is going to be Marco Velo. Still two teammates on the front, and Astoloi's just got to keep going. He's inside of 800 metres, and he may well have just got it, but you know this sprint, when the sprint starts to unleash, they're kicking in at 60 kilometres an hour.
800 metres, he's now at 600 metres. He's got a good chance. Half a kilometre, the line's an awful long way, though, when the peloton are right behind and have yet to open up the sprint. Final lead out for Petacchi, who doesn't want to move until he has to. And Olaf Pollock is again moving up towards the front here now, but Astoloa swamped at about 400 metres to the line here. It was a brave effort and it would have been a great result, but that's all history now as Petacchi is poised for win number three. No sign of McEwen. Pollock has got the wheel of Petacchi. Pollock, who keeps finishing second, and I think he's going to be second again because Alessandro Petacchi is going to get his third win. Pollock is coming, but he gives up on the line. Petacchi gets it, and poor old Olaf Pollock is second yet again.
Nice tactical move there on the way, and it's like there's been a crash just after the finishing line. Actually, this was after the finishing. I think that is one of Mario Cipollini's teammates who's gone down very hard there. That is, I think, the Estonian rider, Andrus Oos.
Well, I've no idea what happened because our camera's just picking it up, but it doesn't look at all well. He must have clipped somebody, perhaps in the crowd, maybe a photographer there, as he sprinted through the line. It's always a hazardous situation, I have to say. But he really seems to have taken a bad knock there.
Well, I didn't see it at all, but I think it was just after the finishing line that he went down.
It is Oos.
And number 12, yeah.
It is Oos.
72, I mean.
Yeah, that's him, 72. And there's confirmation. Well, let's hope he's OK. There's the field looking a little bit perplexed after that finish in the rain. And this man, he must wonder what's hit him.
Well, he went down very hard in the confusion. Let's have a look and see if we can see where it happened, because just coming up through the finish, you can see there Andrus Oos is on the wheel of his teammate there, Naudos. There at the front end, there's no confusion at all. Alessandro Petacchi gets himself the win ahead of Olaf Polak. But there, just look at that.
Ouch.
Just after the finishing line, two teammates actually colliding,
yeah.
And Oos was just touching the back wheel of Naudos. There was nowhere to go, and he went down very hard.
He hit that back wheel, and I suppose, technically, it's nobody's fault except their own there, touch your wheels, but it was a nasty fall clipping that barrier. I think he might have broken his collarbone here. Well, of course, officially he's in the race. It won't be till tomorrow we will know if he starts or not, because he has crossed the finishing line. But the terrible conditions here, the accident happens off to the right of our picture. There's no doubt about the sprinting prowess of Alessandro Petacchi. He's got three wins now. And Olaf Pollock there, I think he's got 3 seconds, including plus the prologue. There's the touch straight at the camera.
Well, that was very nasty, and there was nothing he could do. You see, as I said earlier, Phil, once you touch the brakes, in a situation like this where it's very, very wet, the bike doesn't slow down at all for a few seconds, and I think we're going to see Andrus Oos there being evacuated to hospital. The ambulance men on hand very quickly indeed. It was over to the right-hand side, and not at all to affect the final sprint of Alessandro Petacchi, who gets himself a very clean victory. But that was rather embarrassing, that moment there, for Domino Vacanzi.
Just watch Nasdaq's here. So you can't see, but he hit the back wheel of Nasdaq's. There's the result anyway. Another win for Petacchi, another second for Pollock. Barajo, the sprinter there, also coming into his own now. He's got a third place. Nasdaq's crosses the line in fifth and Oos in seventh, but Oos now in doubt of starting tomorrow.
But good to see Freddy Rodriguez up there in sixth position. Freddy's been consistently in the top 10 or 12 places over the last few days. There's been no change at all in the overall classification. Gilberto Simoni still leads there by 13 seconds from his own teammate.
That is the overall situation at the end of stage number six. Petacchi is now back in the lead of this race in points. Wegmann back in the lead in the King of the Mountains. We haven't seen too much of those mountains yet. But the leader is still Gilberto Simoni. Completes another day in the Maglia Rosa. On we go. Stage seven now. From Frosinone to Montevergine di Mercogliano. 214 kilometres this one, the second category climb with 22 kilometres to go, the Monteforte Erpino. And that could be the springboard for the boys to break away for the finish. And as we look here at the images of the start, in that crash here, it is now, I'm afraid, a no-go for Andrus Oos, out with his injuries, and also joining him is team leader Mario Cipollini, not recovering from the crash he had 2 days ago. Both riders from Domino Vacanzi go out of the Giro d'Italia at the start of stage seven. That's really sad.
Very sad for the team that we expected, but it's again the story of the first week of the Giro, another crash out on the open road, and it looked very much to me as if that was one of the riders from Vini Calderola, Zampieri, who went down quite hard with the French rider Nicolas Fritsch.
Yeah, well, they've had a touch of wheels on a rather silly straight. Well, they're saying it's Olivier Zug, but that's what his not what his number says at all. Oh, yes, I beg the pardon, Paul. It is Olivier Zug, the Swiss rider on Sonia Duval, who has taken the fall quite heavily. Young man, nasty. He's waiting for a bike here. And they could do with getting it to him a little bit quickly, because it's warmed up today, but it's still a long way back to the peloton, and he'll have a hard job to catch him.
At least the weather's a lot better this afternoon. And different team on the front end of the main field here this afternoon as we go through 20 kilometres to go.
This is through the beautiful area now of Campania. Lush green mountains all of around the riders. They're only tickling them, though, as they feel they're getting themselves a little bit organised, and it's not the team of Fassa Bortolo at the minute. Inside 20 kilometres to go as we head down towards Mercagliano. We're off the mountain now, the long twists of the Erpino. And that was won by Nicky Abersol from Mazzanti and Daniela Righi. 41 seconds back at those two went over the top. They were in an early breakaway today. They've all been swept up now. Six of them being wiped out. The last two being Mazzantanti and Nicky Abersol.
Well, Phonak have been a very prominent team in the early days of the Giro d'Italia here. These two riders.
Oh, these are the two that are still away. This is Nicky Abersol, the last two of that breakaway, and this is the one being Mazzanti.
They're still holding on, but not by very much, because on the front end of the main field, it's basically Vinny Calderola who are doing all of the pacemaking here this afternoon. And that would indicate that Stefano Garzelli feels like he's got a good chance of getting himself the stage win. He may well like this finishing climb towards the end of today's stage, and may well be trying to set himself up for a stage victory.
Well, Mazzanti here on the right of our picture at one stage was the leader of the tour on the road. He's 2:34 off the Maglia Rosa of Gilberto Simoni in 31st place. But as we look up here now, I think they're starting to wind them in. This is the remnants of the breakaway surrendering here. This will be the Lamprey rider being brought back, is it?
Yep, one of the Lamprey riders was in that very early on. Yeah. It was originally a group of six riders, and they built themselves up a massive advantage of over 6 minutes at one stage, but over the last few kilometres it slowly but surely started to come down. The teammates of Stefano Garzelli on the front, and they're waiting now to catch the final two survivors of that six-man breakaway.
They've done most of the work, Garzelli's teammates. I find that rather strange, when really they were... It should have been the job of the Saeco team to chase down that breakaway. The only dangerous man in it, if there were any danger men in it, was Luca Mazzanti. At 2:34 down, a call for service here at the back of the race by Radoslav Regina, who is the champion, by the way, of Croatia.
Flat tire for him. And you see how he's not panicking at all. He's actually waiting for the team manager's car to come up right behind him. And that's the best thing to do, just to keep it nice and calm and wait for the team manager to get behind you. And once the team car is there, that's the moment when you should stop and take out the wheel. These are the two leaders. They've not got very much more than a minute's advantage right now over the main field, and they don't really look to me, Phil, as if they've got the firepower to hold off the accelerating main field.
No, the field, I mean, the field is not too far off the back of them right now. They're the only two survivors of the breakaway of six that went away after 6 kilometres, after 12 kilometres, 7 miles of racing today. We're now heading in to the last 15 or 16 kilometres of the race, and it looks to me as though they're about to be brought back. There's an interesting shot for you. They've just come across from the other side. Now we're going back down the road here, around the roundabout. The peloton virtually all together. That's the latest time check, a minute and 15 seconds. They didn't really escape the grips of the peloton at all today, because the biggest gap they got was a shade over 6 minutes.
Still holding on to a minute of that advantage. But you can see the main field is starting to take this final few kilometres very seriously indeed. I think this afternoon we could very well see the challenge coming from Stefano Garzelli, who, by the fact that he sent all of his teammates to the front, must feel that his legs are good and he's got the chance of getting himself a win. There's been no work done on the front of the main field this afternoon by Fassa Bortolo, because obviously they're going to take a back seat with the mountaintop finish here today.
Well, we'll see just what happens here, because this group now has gone over the big climb, really, the Monteforti Erpino, as it tops out with 22 kilometres left to ride, but it's still going to be a tough finish, and you're right. I just can't work out why Sonia Duval have done a lot of the work today, and also the team of Garzelli. And here we go again now, Tenax having another little dig with Renzo Mazzolini. We saw him before a couple of days ago. Now he's trying to open it all up again here, so he's a glutton for punishment, this man. It would be nice to see this small team make a go of it. You know, if the Pro Tour materialises as planned next year, you won't be seeing teams like Tenax in this race, because if you haven't got the big bucks to put into this Pro Tour, you simply won't be riding in the big tours. I'm not sure I agree with the Pro Tour, but we'll see how it pans out.
There's a lot more discussion, I think, going to have to take place before that actually comes to fruition. Certainly, it's the smaller teams in many of the big tours that make for the aggressive racing. And that's a big question mark, I think, that hovers over the future of the Pro Tour. This man hasn't got that much of an advantage over the main field. And as you can see, the team on the front is, in fact, that's Team Saeco, who are riding in different coloured jerseys here this afternoon. And if you get a chance to see the jerseys that they're riding in, they've got "Legalize My Cannondale" written all over them, because the Cannondale, in fact, is inside of the regulation weight, and they actually have to make the machine heavier to have it as a legal entity.
These are the boys here at the top of the climb, straining to see who's at the front of the peloton. They haven't got the vision that we've got, of course. Here's the two leaders, they're still clear. Just under 16 kilometres to go. There's no way they're going to stay away now. But coming back to what you're saying there, Paul, about Saeco, they'll catch themselves a bucket full of fines tonight for coming out in the incorrect team strip, but I don't think they'll care, because they've taken a lot of publicity from this black and white horizontal stripe strip that they're in today. And we'll probably get a glimpse of it here. Come the helmets off now. This is the workhorse on the Lamprey team, Daniele Righi, who was in the breakaway and is probably now quite tired, so he's offered to pick up all of the hats and he'll take them back to the car, and then he'll just ride home to the finish, because he'll be too tired to hold the peloton up this mountain.
Well, that's an indication that they've started the climb. Any race that finishes with a climb in excess of 5 kilometres means the riders are allowed to take off their helmets and their dedication. And a lot of dedication since the start of the Giro to the departed Marco Pantani, Il Pirata, who passed away earlier on this year on the eve of Valentine's Day on the 13th of February.
Looking now at one rider here trying to set up the fight here. This will be a Selle Italia rider who's going,
Raffaele Illiano. He's been very aggressive since the start of this season as well. We've seen him early on in the races like the Tour de Langkawi. He's a kind of rider who throws complete and utter caution to the wind. This is a very aggressive team, actually, this Colombia Selle Italia team. And although it's a team that doesn't have a huge budget, they certainly managed to get the team lots of publicity in the races that they participate around the world.
Well, it's his third year as a pro, Illiano. He's not won any races of note. He won the prologue on the stage of the Tour Senegal, but I'm not too sure that's a world-class event.
It's a long way from the northern climes of Europe. Anyway, this is Illiano halfway across the gap. The two leaders are still holding on to around about 55 seconds of their advantage. And we did just catch a glimpse of Team Fassa Bortolo abandoning en masse the company of the main field, not the race itself, but just riding up to the summit of this climb in a certain amount of comfort and accompanying the leader of the points classification, Alessandro Petacchi.
Well, 15 kilometres to go now, and Illiano trying to add some firepower. There they are, the boys of Fassa Bortolo, having a look at Petacchi, who's in the pink again. No reaction from him, so they'll look after him and take him home today. There'll be no sprint for the finish, not when you see this climb as it hairpins its way up to the summit. It'll be a day for the climbers, and there might be a shift in the Maglia Rosa.
It's a pretty impressive climb, actually, as you can see these riders going through the helmets off part. There's a sign actually at the side of the road which indicates the moment that the riders are allowed to take off their helmets. It also gives the team helpers at the side of the road there a chance to hand up some bottles as well. You can see now though that they are inside of the last 10 miles of climbing, inside of 15 and a half kilometers to go to the summit. Just at the back here on the far side is the leader of the Intergiro classification, that's Crescenzo D'Amore. Mariano Piccoli,
former winner of the King of the Mountains and the points competition, Piccoli, which is a good mix for you, sprinter and climbing. Here's the two leaders, nice and warm for them today after the drowning they got yesterday, which took Oge out of the race at the finish, but I think they'll be caught shortly. This is Illiano here now.
He's been joined by Muraglia, the man who was on the attack yesterday. Now it's interesting how these smaller teams are so aggressive. They're hoping, I think, that there's going to be some kind of marking amongst the big names, but certainly not now.
That one.
That didn't last very long. Once the team of Saeco decide to put the hammer down, it brings everything back together. And this is the strip that they've got. You can see this afternoon, they will get a serious fine for this in the blue and white strip, bearing the...
I'll tell you what, they're obviously in the same mood they were in when they came up the corner del Scala, because they're trying to shake this out again in their favour. So Gilberto Simoni triumphed there and took the pink jersey. This is what happened at the back of the race when the pressure goes on at the front. They all wave goodbye.
The with Schmidt on the front there for Saeco, who was whipping up the pacemaking. And as soon as they do put the pressure on, a lot of riders showing that fatigue is starting to creep in. This looks like Nicky Ebersolt is the lone survivor there off the front end of the main field. But as we pull back, we get an indication that the main field really is in angry mood now.
Steady climbs here, and this is the split of the leaders now. This is Nicky Ebersolt. And it looks as though once you start to split like this, it's a final desperate attempt, but it's not still too far to go to the top today for Nicky. He was first over the Monteforti Irpino, and Mazzanti second. They were clear at that point by 40 seconds over the breakaway, which was not too far ahead of the peloton. All changing now. They're both together just as they continue, but judging by the way they are riding, it won't be long before the pack. In fact, I'm not too sure. We sprung that very quickly. It could be coming up here.
Well, this man was national champion of Switzerland back in 1998. He turned pro back in 1996. But right now he's hoping he's going to survive off the front end of the main field. But with Team Saeco in dominant fashion on the front end of the peloton, I don't think that's going to be the outcome of this afternoon stage.
I think if our camera swings around, we're going to see the peloton riding pretty close here. Lost the... Well, there they are, right on the tail here. And Ebersolt is going to be the last one to be caught. Then it is going to be Peloton Groupe all together. And it's the Saeco riders who are just continuing at the pace setting here, trying once again on a mountain finish to stamp their authority on this year's Giro d'Italia.
Specialetti on the front, followed there by Eddie Mazzolini. Zampieri not too far away. Gilberto Simoni looking cool as a cucumber there in his pink jersey. Very happy with the way the race is developing as we speak. Not too far behind him, Damiano Cunego. There he is, just peeping up into about fifth or sixth position.
And Garzelli again trying to mark there. Simoni just on his back wheel. But he hasn't really distinguished himself at all just now in this year's Giro. But it's one man to me, it appears, against the whole of the Saeco team. And he's got to work out his tactics just to play his cards absolutely right. Otherwise, he'll pay in price. Nice study in motion there.
Specialetti just thinking about riding a tempo for the rest of the team until the big names take over.
Big names going off the back here, Paul. Because that's the world champion, Astaloa.
Well, that's surprising because he had shown some pretty good form over the last couple of days, but maybe he's decided he's not going to be in for the kill at the end of today's stage. He wants to conserve a little bit of energy down towards the end, but it's a very heavy jersey to wear that, maybe not in weight, but certainly in prestige. And the world champion there going off the back of what is still a fairly large group.
It is very surprising. He was showing excellent form. There's Piccoli. I must say that it's the curse of the world champion's jersey, I think. Once you win the world title, you never seem to ride well the following year. And Astaloa finding the weight of that jersey rather heavy this year. That's the little details for you of where we're going. We're going up to 1,260 metres, a maximum gradient of 1 in 10 or 10%. And that's going to be a tough one. It's going to give the strongmen a chance here to get away.
Vladimir Belli from Lampre moving up to the front end of the main field. But obviously, once again, every time we come to a critical mountain stage, it's Team Saeco who want to stamp the authority all over the front end of this main field.
A lot of concentration on the faces of these riders here now. They're all asking themselves, have they got the legs to go when the move comes? And it's certain to come too. Simoni riding deep in the leader part of the peloton here.
There's Belli in the Lamprey. There's Gilberto Simoni looking nice and comfortable in the middle of the pack there. He's got a very solid team here at the Giro d'Italia.
Cunego riding well there. In fact, he's riding right on the front of Simoni as if he's trying to help him. There's a television looking at a television. Don't often see that.
very artistic director we've got here this afternoon. There is Honchar. Gonchar. On the right-hand side, champion of Ukraine, Specialetti, still the man on the front doing all of the pacemaking. Steve Zampieri is never very far away. I think he's going to be a big ally later on for Stefano Garzelli. The team of Vinny Calderolo have done an awful lot of work here, and I think that's because Garzelli thinks he's got the chance of a win.
Well, he usually pops up in an early stage of the Giro with a stage win, the winner before, so the Giro d'Italia, Stefano Garzelli. Like Simoni, coming back from a little bit of disgrace from being involved with doping, but Simoni was exonerated later. And now he's come to prove yet another point. Try and defend his championship won last year. 10 kilometres still to go. And if they keep this sort of tempo up, there won't be more than 10 riders together at the finish, I don't think.
Julio Perez at the back there in the orange jersey of Panaria. And just alongside him there was Charlie Vergelius, wearing number 69, the young British rider, who was a very integral part of this Dinardi team.
Yes, he'll be very pleased, because Charlie's got a very defined job in this race, and that's to help team captain Sergei Gonchar make a good result. And he'll be the last sort of post, I think, for Gonchar in the mountains, because Charlie's a pretty good climber. And he's just sitting near the back at the moment. He knows what his team leader is. There's nobody of note amongst the leaders missed this move yet.
Well, there's Pavel Tonkov. He's actually riding very well here at the Giro d'Italia. Seems to be enjoying riding for a smaller team. He's certainly not looking for a high place in the overall classification. He's really been brought into this team, I think, to look after Stefano Garzelli. And he's the kind of rider who has got so much tactical knowledge on board that that's the thing to have alongside a man who's trying to win the Giro d'Italia. And that's certainly why I think he's just enjoying possibly his last season as a professional.
Selina Specialetti, he rides like this, and yet he's 22 minutes behind overall. His job is very, very simple. He is a domestique on the squad. It's his job now to keep the pace high and try and stop anybody attacking the leaders of the tour, and then drop off when others take over and lose time, because time to him is unimportant. But Specialetti doing a great job here of destroying some of the tail of this field. And he's got plenty of help too. There's Mazzolini. Then we go back into the heat of the moment here. Gilberto Simoni at 9 kilometres, looking as though he's relishing the last 9 kilometres. I wouldn't be surprised to see him go again.
Stefano Garzelli's not far away. He's always very close to his own teammate, Steve Zampieri, who's looking pretty good. And I think this is another rider scooting out of the back there. Looks like Bo Hamburger, who's also slipping off the back end of the peloton.
Yes, they hang as long as they can, and then they just say that is...
In fact, he was waiting for his own team leader, Gerard Trompuch, who must have had a mechanical incident there. Just caught it just a few moments ago. Now, he's pretty high up in the overall classification, which is why Hamburger is sat up to wait for him to pace him back into the main field.
He's had a great start to the Giro, there's no doubt about that. He was reaching to change his front wheel there. There's Garzelli. Now, this is mano a mano, because this is the two big rivals, the two big Giro winners, the two big Giro champions, Garzelli, Simoni. Look at that. Don't even look at each other. Just keep telling each other with motion who is going the best.
This is a psychological battle going on between these two riders here. And in cycling jargon, what they would say is they're actually breathing out of their ears, because they don't want the other guy to see that they're under any pressure at all, just trying to keep the face nice and calm and not show any of the inner struggle that's going on. There is Cunego looking pretty comfortable. There's Gonchar. Popovic over in the white jersey on the right-hand side. David Rebellin. He's never been very close to the front, but never been very far away, and he could be the big surprise in the latter part of the Giro, although he's never been really good in the big mountains.
Riders taking the chance here to just move up a little bit.
It's tough being a teammate. You've just got to go to the front when you're on a big squad like this and ride your heart out until you can do it no longer, and then just pull off and try and survive and make sure you can stay in the race once you get up to the summit of the climbs.
There's still a lot of racing to come on this climb, though. Just caught sight there in the green jersey. First time we've seen him, actually, Fabian Wegmann. Now the pressure. This is Simoni. He's itching to have a go. Is he going to try? He's testing Garzelli. Garzelli's gone with him. Figueras is number 31 there. And it's Figueras who's going to put in a little bit of a move here. So now that's it. They've started the moves now. Then I think we're going to find Simoni will react to this one. This is Igor Pugacci from Dinardi. Now, he's the teammate of Sergei Gonchar. He's freewheeling round the bend there because he's come right up behind the bikes.
He's joined there by a rider from Panario as well, and it looked to me for a moment as if Gilberto Simoni was going to put the hammer down very early on.
And in fact, it's not the rider as I thought.
Emmanuel Seller is the young rider who's come up here.
He's never had a win. He's a young pro.
Yep, he's a very young bike rider, 17th in the overall classification, a minute 45 down. But you see these guys are now being very, very observant. This is, again, teammates of Gilberto Simoni on the front end of the main field. Look how quickly Seller was ticking over that pedaling revolutions there. He was really spinning at around about 110 revolutions a minute. This man is obviously a very good climber. Never heard very much about him in the past, but he's obviously a pretty good man because this is a select group already.
Well, they have a habit of They're sending new names to the things like the Tour of Italy rather than not the Tour de France. He's only 23, Emmanuel Selle, and he has never won a race in his life, but then he's only been a pro about 5 months.
Well, there's Simoni there in the front end of the main field.
Look at this, Simoni getting, I thought he was on his radio there, from, I think he was.
Figueres.
Now this is the attack I thought it was when Selle went, because it may have softened the ground up Selle to allow Figueres to attack. He's been riding pretty well, he's gone now, again he's up amongst it. The motorbikes have got to be more alert when riders sprint off the front.
Well, he's in sixth place in the overall classification. He's only 45 seconds off the lead. Now, he's the kind of rider that maybe Gilberto Simoni won't feel has got a very good chance of winning overall after 3 weeks of racing, and might force some of the other riders to take up the pacemaking and chase him down. But I tell you what, when he went, he opened up the gap pretty quickly. This is Selle going again.
Well, they've come back together. Sellers tried to go again. Well, you better look left now, because Simoni has gone this time and Gozzelli was ready for him. And I think maybe Simoni may slow down. Now he's been quickly marked by Gozzelli, then followed by Figueres. Selle has found his legs again, and this rider coming right on top, Eddie Mazzolini. It's all back together, and a counter move straight away from Selle, or is it? Yes.
Yep. This is great. This is fabulous to see a young rider. This is turning out to be very much the Giro d'Italia of the young riders. A lot of new names coming to the fore. Selle is going to just try and blow the front end of this race apart if he can, to set something up for his teammate Giuliano Figueres, who is riding there in about fifth place. Oh, this is the leader, by the way, of the King of the Mountains classification.
Yes, he won the very first climb of the Giro, which is just on a week ago now. And Fabian Wegmann in trouble when the big boys are turning the screw a little bit tighter. And Selle still got Zelli, Paul, marks only Simoni. He's not looking at anybody else's attacks.
No, he's sitting right on the wheel of Gilberto Simoni. Emmanuel Selle just keeps accelerating. The reason is because they're trying to set something up for Figueres here. Another good move, and look at that. Straight onto his wheel is Damiano Cunego.
Well, that was they're obviously marking man for man like a football match here now. Looks like Cunego's job to look after Figueres. Remember, Figueres could take the lead here, but not while he's got Cunego on his back wheel, that's for sure. And if those two riders go away, then it would be pink jersey staying with Saeco, but changing shoulders and going across to Cunego.
Difficult situation, though, for Cunego here. He's second overall in the classification, 13 seconds in arrears. And listen to all those motorbikes hitting their horns. They're trying to get out of the way. The race referee, I'm sure right now, is shouting, clear out, get away from the front end of the race. This is at the back of the group. This is David Rebellin, and he's not looking very comfortable at all. In fact, he's looking a little bit podgy.
Yes, he is. He looks as though he's got nothing like his form, but he didn't really want to ride this race. The team more or less persuaded him. His heart doesn't appear to have been in it since the start, because he's nursing good form for the single-day classics. These two are going clear. Now, Cunego is playing absolutely the perfect teammate here. He's not helping the attack, and yet he knows that if this breakaway succeeds, he'll be the next leader.
Well, it would be a great move for him. That looks like Bradley McGee. In fact, no, Philippe Gilbert, who's going off the back of the group there. Gilbert has done very well to stay in contact with this group. There is Rebellin.
I think he's going off the back at the moment. He's not enjoying it either.
He certainly doesn't look very comfortable at all there. 115 with the bleached blonde hair at the back end of the group. And I think his kilometres are numbered here as to whether or not he stays in contact with the main field.
When you get down onto the whip end, you know that if there's another rapid acceleration at the front, you're the next one to get detached.
Zampieri.
And this is the front now. Zampieri has got in amongst it for Gozzelli. Cunego is here. They've come back up to the two leaders now. The status quo again. Zampieri takes a good look at Figueres, as if almost to say, what are you doing?
Well, I have to say, Gilberto Simoni has to say a very big thank you there to Damiano Cunego, because he played the absolute perfect teammate. He went with the move, but never contributed at all to it. And at 23 years of age, that must have been very difficult, because he obviously was dreaming about the possibility of the pink jersey.
Yeah, but these professionals, all for one on the Saeco team at the moment. And both of the riders now clearly sitting on very good form for the competition here. And you wouldn't have thought that a couple of weeks ago. Simoni wasn't showing good form at all, but he came good just before this race got underway. They like to come in a little bit below top form.
Oh,
ride
Rebellin
themselves in. Rebellin's gone. There he is at the end.
Struggling, and there's not many riders left, but he's lost two or three bicycle lengths. I think the next time we get an acceleration, we can say goodbye to David Rebellin. Look at the face here on Steve Zampieri. He really believes that his man there in about fifth position, Stefano Garzelli, can win the race from this group here this afternoon.
5 kilometres to go. And Rebellin in trouble. That's 3 miles still to climb. And Rebellin set now to lose big time because he's been unhooked. If there's no slowing down of the pace, and it looks to be about 20, 25 riders still up there. Bit surprised to see Rebellin detach at this stage. But I do feel, after his marvellous World Cups campaign, that his heart is not in this race.
Now it's very difficult. 5 kilometres to go and still a fairly compact group with Steve Zampieri doing an incredibly long turn on the front end of the main field, and not too far away either is Pavel Tonkov. Now he's riding, look at that, he's riding alongside there Stefano Garzelli. He'd be talking to Garzelli, asking him how he is, giving him words of encouragement, because I think that's what they've brought him on board here for with Vinny Calderolo, to look after Stefano Garzelli, who they believe. Now look at that, you see. Yep. This man has got so much talent. Just let me come by. I'll dictate the pace. We don't want to put our leader under too much pressure. And then we'll try and accelerate as we get just that little bit closer towards the finish.
Yes, that was fine riding there by the man with the experience. Just tapping Zampieri on the shorts there, saying, just cool it for a moment. Let me set the pace and take a break.
Oof, but look at the tempo he's dictating. This is
about
amazing.
Taking a break, making a break maybe.
I'm not sure I like his haircut, but he certainly still got the power that took him to the victory in the Giro d'Italia a couple of years ago, and he's put his own teammate under a certain amount of pressure. Even Gilberto Simoni didn't look very comfortable there. Eddie Mazzolini just in front of Yaroslav Popovic. As we get a chance to look at the back end of the main field, and there's a one or two riders here, are certainly hoping that Pavel Tonkov is going to just ease it off a little bit.
The Colombian La Verde last in the line there.
There's Brad McGee.
Brad McGee still in there, isn't he?
Yep. Pavel Tonkov popped his teammate there, Steve Zampieri. They're now trying to set this up for Stefano Garzelli. They want to see if there's any weakness in the armour of Gilberto Simoni. And I tell you what, he's not only hurting Gilberto Simoni, he's hurting everybody else in this group. And this is a big group of names.
4 kilometres left to climb, a little bit less than that now. Just on 2.25 miles left to go to the top. There's still a big group here and nobody able to get away. And I think the reason that Tonkov has come here is to steady this pace. I think it was getting a little bit of a rough ride for Garzelli, or he wants to put Garzelli in a position to try and go for it alone.
Well, the size of the group right now would certainly really suit a man like Stefano Garzelli. He's no stranger at all to winning mountaintop finishes from a small group like this. Bertagnoli at the back there for Saeco, he's saying, oh, please let me go to the front and do a bit of work for Gilberto Simoni. But all he can do is just scramble to stay in contact.
8 days we've been running now in the Giro d'Italia. And there's no sign of a clear leader, but Simoni doing everything right and trying not to use too much of his energy until we get to the big mountains. His arch rival in previous Giri is Garzelli, and there he is, sat right behind Cunego. And I think there that Pavel Tonkov wasn't too happy with the proximity of the television cameras.
I know, he was asking them to get out of the way because he feels that they're in fact causing the acceleration at the front end of the peloton. But look at the work that he's done there, because that has reduced the number of riders to not very many more than 20.
I think it's back to 18 or 19. A quick count from the helicopter there, and I got lost after 18. But that looks about what it is now, as you can see a little bit of the angle of the climb here now. We're looking for the 3 kilometre banner.
Dario Cioni is still in there, and he's going to ride high in the overall classification. And Brad McGee is still in contact there, just at the back end of the group. Now, he seems to be riding himself into pretty good form here. Now, another move by Figueras, followed immediately by Cunego.
Well, Cunego has obviously been told he's got to follow Figueras today, and he's not letting the side down. Here we go again. Figueras has advertised all the way up this mountain. He wants to win the stage. He's in a high position overall, marked out of it. Tonkov gets himself back on the front. Now he's followed by Simoni. Then Garzelli. Figueras drops back in. We're at 3 kilometres now. Cunego, this revelation of the year in Italy, certainly, and in the world, I think, also. He's still looking. He always looks under pressure the way he rides, and his mouth wide open. But he's got so much talent.
He might look under pressure, but he's always there. He is ever present. And the way he's riding as the ultimate team domestique. He's riding a protective race for his own team leader. Every time there's an acceleration, he goes with it, but he never contributes to the success of the breakaway because he is the teammate of the leader, Gilberto Simoni. Simoni there in third place. Tonkov just sitting at the front here, free to ride the tempo that he wants because he's not trying to conserve any energy at all in the Giro. He's not been brought here to win the race. He's been brought here to look after Stefano Garzelli. Look at Emanuel Seller on the left-hand side there, bouncing all over that bike. He's only 22 years of age, you know. He's a very young bike rider.
So as he now gets to grips with things, only a professional since the start of this year, certainly established himself as a rider to watch. And they've got a 22-year-old Cunego sitting right on his back wheel there. Two of the futures of the sport in Italy, I think. Although Selle himself is still to establish himself as a winner. But look at the turn of effort here. And this has got to be to try and help his team leader, Figueras. But Figueras has got to be impressed by this effort.
But look who's on his wheel. Yeah. Damiano Cunego just
Marked
sitting there
so far.
Every time. Every time something goes, Cunego is there. He's bouncing around from left to right, just going with all of the accelerations in the back of his mind, just thinking about protecting the position of his leader, Gilberto Simoni, who's never looked under any pressure at all. Stefano Garzelli is still there, but I think under a bit of pressure because he does not really look all that comfortable. Vladimir Belli on the left-hand side. He's one of those riders who is always present as well, and I think we will always remember him as being the man who was ejected from the Giro d'Italia for punching somebody on the nose when he was lying in third place in the overall classification.
That's right, the Simoni hooligans got a little bit out of control, and poor old Belli unleashed his wrath and was out. And at the time, I think he was lying third overall. That was the end of him. Very sad, really. And Simoni should have told his hooligans to calm it down as well, because they were crowding out a little bit on the mountain that day. But Selle is incredible just now, and I think really I can't see the point of him setting a pace like this just at the minute.
No, I think because he's actually making too fast a pace to allow his own teammate there in fifth position, Figueras, to actually get off the front and launch an attack. Those people were getting just a little bit too close for my liking there. The Tifosi go absolutely wild towards the end of a race here.
But they flew around that corner. I mean, they're going uphill. They almost overshot the corner. And Selle, just gritting his teeth, the adrenaline flow in him is so high, I don't think he cares where anybody is just now. But look at the face being pulled by Garzelli. It gives you some idea of the effort being made by Emanuel Selle. Cunego looking cool. Here goes Simoni now. Rapid acceleration by Simoni. Now, that's what we expected, a chance to improve. A little bit of a slow reaction there coming from Garzelli, but he's come and he's got the wheel. And then Cunego, the big three, are on the move.
Well, Stefano Garzelli obviously has the legs this afternoon. His team did the majority of the work in the last 25 kilometres before we came to the start of the climb to pull back the early morning six-man breakaway. And the responsibility now is on the shoulders of Stefano Garzelli to get himself the win. That indication that Gilberto Simoni was pulled back there is an indication that maybe he's not as strong as he was last year, although this climb is not quite the steepness that Gilberto Simoni likes. Look at the Tifosi on the right-hand side there, just coming alongside, trying to encourage everybody. Mazzolini, always present, always ready to come and work for the team.
Well, the last kilometre, and we will continue uphill here now, and Eddie Mazzolini is trying to launch Simoni and Cunego, the two big hitters on Saeco, up towards the line, because small bonuses there will help today, because quite a few riders have managed to master this pace, and one of the big surprises, having lost his pink jersey on a mountain today, Brad McGee is right in with this group.
There he is, just sitting at the back end of the group there. It's interesting to see Mazzolini just turning up the pace now with Gilberto Simoni in second position. Still in with a chance of the victory there is Stefano Garzelli moving up into fourth place. Honchar is there. All of the big names are here. The only man who's really missed out from the top end of the overall classification is David Rebellin.
That's right, and Rebellin tailed off 5 kilometres down the mountain and is losing time now. There is a very select group that's coming up the mountain just now. And also in there, we haven't mentioned him too much, is Popovic and also the ever-present Andrea Noe in this leading group. And the big surprise, I suppose, is Emanuel Selle, who has done so much work in this group.
So Eddie Mazzolini leading around the corner. We're down to around about 15 riders now. Second place is still Simoni. Cunego is still there in third. Popovic is very comfortably in this group. Dario Cioni is up there as well. This is Popovic coming around the outside now. He could very well be looking for the win.
Well, small bonuses could swing this race the other way, and Simoni could throw it away, but he's making a lot of pace here.
I think Simone is going to try and lead it out for his teammate there, because in second position there you can see Damiano Cunego, and he has to be the man who's got the acceleration. He's had six wins so far this season.
That's right, and Gartelli, watch for Gartelli, a perfect finish for Gartelli this, as they come up towards the line now. This is Figueras again trying to go. There's Brad McGee gritting his teeth. He may have ambition, but I think we're going to see Damiano Cunego be the man of the day. If Cunego wins this, he will take the pink jersey, but it stays with Saeco. And he's got a big gap there, and it's Brad McGee over Pellizzotti, who's come out of nowhere. It's all too late. Cunego, win number seven of the year. McGee, Pellizzotti, Figueras, Gardzelli as they come over the line there. And that is going to see the pink jersey swing back to Damiano Cunego.
Just coming across there was Dario Cioni and Eddie Mazzolini coming in now, an integral part of that team victory here this afternoon. But this climb has certainly caused some pretty serious gaps once again, and what a superbly timed sprint there. I do believe that Gilberto Simoni in the last kilometre, Phil, decided he wanted to try and lead out his own teammate. So good was the acceleration of Damiano Cunego in the last 150 metres.
Well, Cunego's certainly tasting all the leaders' jerseys, Paul. He's had the points, he's now got the King of the Mountains today, as well as a return to the pink jersey. He's having a terrific tour. This is his second tour. Remember, last year he was the youngest rider in the Giro d'Italia and on the Saeco team. There's the result, though. Cunego firing. Big surprise. Bradley McGee has produced the sprint of his life for second place there on the mountaintop. And Pellizzotti in the frame of Figueras as well.
Well, that's the amazing thing. If you look at that picture there, there is no sign at all of Bradley McGee. Big acceleration coming from Damiano Cunego, who gets the gap on everybody else, and I'm pretty sure that they will give him that gap. Then all of a sudden, creeping in from nowhere at all, comes Bradley McGee, who's had the pink jersey on two occasions here, and he comes almost up to the back wheel of the Italian revelation of the year, Cunego, to get himself second place. And I think Brad McGee will be very pleased with that.
I think he'd be absolutely delighted with it, because here's a man who won the prologue. He lost the pink jersey, got it back. He hasn't got the pink jersey back, nor is he likely to get it again. But he now might be thinking of a high finish in the overall classification, which would be a great tour for him. Here we go. This is the daily bottle opening ceremony that sometimes goes a little bit wrong. But Damiano Cunego is having an incredible Giro to back up an incredible season. Win number seven this year for him.